I'm Pekka Rinne. You're listening, Missin Curfew.
Up Dog, Good Life Clothing.
Our boys at Good Life, always looking fresh, so clean.
Shipping to Canada. They're doing it for the boys now. Everybody up there that's been dying for this, it's up there. They're shipping to Canada. I'm telling you, the sweatshirts are unbelievable. You got to check it out. Promo code Curfew for 20% off. Up Dog.
I mean, look at this tarp.
You got one on right now,
this
baby.
This tarp is nice. And I've had this for a while. It only gets softer and softer. But our friends at Good Life, trust them. Trust them for your everyday tee. Because your girl, I mean, we talk about this. Your girls are going to steal, you know, the odd t-shirt. They're going to, you know, you're going to get pinned one day, drop a little red wine on it. You want to grab a freshie. They got the 3-in-1 bundles too. Actually, 4 for the price of 3.
Wow.
The bundle.
They're unbelievable.
So don't be shy. Don't get the, you know, don't cheap out.
Go yeah, and for you guys out there that maybe don't want to throw a collared shirt on, hey, listen, I've been there. But hey, the old lady, the girlfriend, the wife's on you, the Henleys, you can dress them up with a nice little sweater, put them over top. They're soft, they're comfortable, and you can wear them out to that dinner when your girlfriend or wife wants you to dress up. Rock the Henley.
I mean, hey, soon springtime. You're going to need that spring colors. You're going to need to freshen up the wardrobe.
They got the long sleeve Henleys too. Check those bad boys up. You roll them up. If you're a little warm like me, you roll them up. They look good. Long sleeve Henleys.
Look good, feel good, play good with our friends at Good Life. That's goodlifeclothing.com. Promo code Curfew.
Curfew, baby. Welcome back to a fresh episode of Missin Curfew. I'm Shane O'Brien.
And I'm Scotty Upshaw.
The Up Dog.
How we doing, big fella?
Big fella, we're back. Nice. Fella tour.
Yeah, we just had a nice little NHL network chat with our girl.
Yeah.
I said Jackie Redman.
I said fart.
You kind of let, yeah, you let a little fart
go. No, I said the word fart. I was trying to say, what was I trying to say?
You were trying to,
Bear, what was I trying to say?
You were trying to say vote.
Vote, and I said fart.
Damn.
I don't know how
live?
You do that.
Live.
It was live. Yeah, those are live.
Maybe they had just had the button. They went.
They boop. Might have had a 5-second.
They had the pinky to stick in your butt to cover the fart up.
Yeah, yeah. I said, that was like the boys Kiefer and Raycroft when they said shart.
He sharted. What does that mean? I tried to fart and I shit.
The fella tour continued on Up Dog. First of all, shout out to this guy, Fish Pucks.
You're like, wait, your I'm name's like, Fish
what?
Pucks.
What's your
like,
name?
Like Fish.
He had,
I'm like, I look at you, I'm like, did he that's say Fish Pucks.
Fish Pucks? He had more fucking lip boomers. He had more candidates on him than I travel with, and I travel like 15 deep.
Was that all he had in those tins or what?
I don't know, man. He had the old school, he had the replica jersey last year of, not the replica, but the Quebec Nordiques Avalanche one that you loved last
saw
year.
That, yeah.
What were those called? Retro jerseys?
Yeah, classics.
He was standing in line. We're going to talk about the autograph session later, but he's standing in line. And he's like, fella. I'm like, what's up, fella? And he's like, he just starts pulling out tins of Canada. He's like, fuck it, lip boomers, man. Where's Up Dog? I'm like, and you're getting blocked. I'm like, he's right here. He's like, and then he was a beauty. So Fish Pucks, shout out to him. Big hockey guy. Big lip boomer guy.
Lip boomers, baby.
I'm going to be honest. I had a lot of people in Nashville yell out Canadips and lip boomers to me. So. I got to be honest. I think what we're doing here at Missin Curfew is
she's
helping
working.
The brand.
She's working, yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I mean, Canadips. I actually brought a bunch of those.
We
I
were
brought
dishing
the peach,
them out to
the
everyone.
New peach flavor, and I bought the green crack.
You had the nice new tins, too.
Yeah, they have the little thing to put your little chewed up ones in top. That's what you've been missing. Buddy, you were going to tell them about
it's
that,
so
weren't you?
Crazy. It's just like the story of my life, right? Like, it just like as my dad, as Peter would say, just a day late and a dollar short, right? Like, that's my whole career. And no, I was thinking about, you know. No, but I was thinking about, bring it up to you
yeah.
and A-Hall or whoever and being like, fuck, they need a new tin because if you're out at somewhere and you can't, you know, you can't get to a
you're
garden.
Throwing it on the ground.
Yeah, you don't want to throw it like, I don't know, you just lift up the tin, boom, put it
biodegradable in. Though, eh?
Yeah, but I guess more if you're at like functions or something, I don't know. Like instead totally. Of being like, hey, excuse me, I got to throw in the garbage can, you just like tuck it in your tin. It's a good idea. And if you throw it in and there's still a little juice left, you take it out of there, you can fucking reuse it. True story.
That's disgusting.
No, it's your own spit.
Yeah, but still.
Yeah, that's why you're not a real chewer.
That is why.
That's why. It's nothing wrong with
it. Also because I puke every time I do it.
I puke my allergies. Ha, la, la. The fella tour Up Dog. Let's first of all, Nashville. What a city.
It's one of the best.
Hard, if to,
if
recognize,
not,
hard to recognize.
It's up there. I love it. hard to recognize. Yeah, I used to walk out of a bar on Broadway, look left, look right, see the whole place, run into four people that you know already who are just tiptoeing into a new bar. And, you know, you knew every bartender's name. They knew all your drinks, you know.
Speaking of bartenders that we know names, Morgan.
Morgan Cash.
I was only there for 1 year, but I never heard that story that we will release eventually. We got some good stuff coming to you guys from Nashville, which we will release here soon. But
ran into our boy Morgan, who he's managing the Tin Roof Broadway. So if you're ever in town, go check him out. Ask for Morgan Cash. But his interview is great, and it really, I think fans would like to, they'll get a good deep dive into what we were like as kids.
Dodge, duck, dip, dive.
Dip, dive, and roll on over.
Yeah, it was crazy. Like, you know, he knew you when you were 19 years old.
Yeah. Yeah, me and Bizzle. I was probably 25. When our boy Bizzle first moved there, he started bartending at the Roof too, and it was me, him, Wes, Jason. So anyway, it was a little family, and, you know, we always have best buddies away from the game, and they were it. So I think our fans will like that one.
Yeah, no, and we do talk about that in the interview, and that's what the Tin Roof Demumbrian had.
Demo.
Like, I know I could go in there as an NHL player. Coming from I was in Vancouver, and I loved the fans of Vancouver. But near the end of my tenure in Vancouver, like, I was, like, you know, going to places where I had my own table, where there was a little bit of, you know, security, where you knew you weren't going to maybe get in shit. Where at the Tin Roof Demumbrian, you go in there, and it had a family feel. Like, I know you could go in there and get as absolutely pinned as you wanted to. They'd make sure you got in a cab back then. No Ubers back then. You had to call a cab, flag one down, and get you home. So, Morgan, thank you, buddy. It was great to see him.
Yeah, and by the way, speaking of the Tin Roof, I got caught at the Tin Roof on Saturday night. I had a 6:30 flight out.
Wow, I thought you
I got caught at the Tin Roof with some old buddies and a bunch of the Preds, and I won't name names, but it was most of them. Until I look down, I'm in the freezer. We're crushing beers back in the freezer. I'm like, this is where I used to go take a piss, right? I used to piss in an empty bottle. I poured down the drain.
You were telling the new Preds, this is where I used to go
piss. Oh, yeah. So I'm like, let's go have a beer back here. You get a piss? Let's watch this. And so anyway, we're back there having beers. Lose track of time. Phone dies, everything, of course. And sure as shit, I look down. It's 4:45. I don't know. 4:45, flight's at 6:20, and I don't have my bags, nothing. Barred my buddy Bo Diddley. I'm like, Bo, call me an Uber right now. Phone's dead. If I didn't fucking get my bags, pack, run down the hallway, check out, threw the guy a 20 for helping me out because he kept my Uber there. It was nuts. But the Tin Roof will get you. And it was nice.
I think the 6:30 a.m. flight will get you more than the Roof will get you. But you put those together, it's a recipe for fucking disaster.
And then how about I get to Houston on my connection, and I'm having breakfast, and Christina texts me and says, oh, you're on a flight in from Houston with my mom. I'm like, what? I haven't slept yet. I'm like, oh, God, this is perfect. So, Susie, thanks for joining me on my second leg, although I slept 3.5 hours on that flight. That was nice.
Yeah. I made the decision when I dropped me and Maxie got pinned in the DraftKings suite, which we're going to get into. And then when I was going into the after party at Patron Club, at that point, I made my decision. I'm not getting on my flight tomorrow at 10:30.
So you stayed a full extra day.
Full day. Soul house. It was awesome. What'd you do? Fucking got up, went in fucking little...
Did you go to the spa? Steamer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Fucking in there. Did a little light, very light, very light bike ride, steam, whatever. Sauna. There was a sauna in there, too.
You got on the bike on Sunday.
I went in there very lightly.
That should have been a photo taken and sent to me for that. I would have.
Well, I showered up and went down there just to get out of my room. But I've I was talking to Max about this before we came on. Like, the feeling that I had on that Jet Suite X flight, of being hungover, I don't have a baby girl like you. I have no reason to get home. I didn't have to work on Monday. Why not take the day? I took the day.
You took the day.
Got up the next day.
Get that company card going. Just take the day. No,
I put the flight change on my own card, so I wouldn't ding the company. But
nah, just keep her going, bud.
Maxie, I think I'm done traveling hungover, bro.
Hey, that was a veteran move on your part.
Yeah, I think I'm done. I got no girlfriend, no wife, no dog. No, I don't need to get home. The privilege of being the single guy with no responsibilities.
I couldn't agree more.
Is to take the day, Maxie.
The day.
Would you not like to have that day?
Oh, I could have used that day. Could I have used that day?
I came home and I had to go for another in-law family dinner. It was not perfect. Yeah, I hung out with Izzy all afternoon and then went to a dinner. I mean, but I'm
it's official, boys. I would be divorced. I would be divorced, but I would not be able to see my baby girl. It would be fucking ugly, man.
Like, I'd be turn out the lights.
I'd be living under a bridge probably or something, right? Like, I don't know how you do it, Uppy. Although we were pros. You know, we 100%. Came in Wednesday night. We saw Pecks and Webbs. We hadn't seen those guys in forever. I got after it Wednesday night. But then Thursday, Friday, we had dinners. And I felt great. So, Soul House, thank you for hooking that up.
Oh, it's great.
To anyone that's a Soul House member, the one in Nashville is National League beyond National League. Brand new. I knew walking in, I could smell the cedar. Like, I was like,
fuck, this is fresh. It smells rich.
With my beak, I can't smell anything. I was like, how can I smell something?
She's a little left. She's a little curved, eh?
She's broke. There's God knows what's going on with it. I get in the room and I take a picture and send it to you. Or I call you. I'm like, these rooms are fucking next. They're unbelievable.
Yeah.
The gym was next level. The food was unbelievable.
I can't wait to get back.
It was great. Yeah, so thank you to Soul House. Another thing I noticed about the Soul House, a lot of girls in leather pants.
Black leather.
Wasn't like that when I was living in Nashville.
Nope. Jeans, boots.
Daisy Dukes.
Yeah.
They've added the black leather pant to the fucking establishment.
What do you think of that?
I think I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
It just me or did we not see like 5 or 6 girls wearing black leather pants or maybe more than that? Like, is that a new trend thing? Am I out of the loop or it was nice?
I don't know. We're going to have to get a stylist.
We'll have to talk to Bex. Rebecca DeMarco could help us out with that. Yeah. Maybe the leather pants are in.
Yeah, there was some. Yeah, there was some leather pants. Yep.
It was a great establishment.
Painted on.
They were painted on. So Soul House, thank you very much.
Yeah, you know what though? It was a little chilly, so you know, come summertime, ain't wearing those black leather pants.
That's why they were bringing them out. And you know what? I thought about
that. Mick Jagger might, but.
You know what? I thought about that on my leisure day at Soul House, leisure day.
Oh, I wish I could take a leisure day.
The only downfall was like, you deserve a leisure day. I might treat you to one. I'll just get you something. Let's go for a day and just fucking turn your phone off. The only bad part was I forgot to tell whatever time I got home to Soul House. I don't know what time it was. It was fucking late.
Was it earlier than me?
I must have just missed you.
Yeah.
I must have just missed you. But I forgot to tell him I was going to extend my stay. So in the morning, the phone started ringing, and I was just like, fucking hung cheese. I'm like, don't answer. It's finally after the fifth time, I'm like, hello!
wake up the bear.
It's like the nicest girl you've ever seen. She's like, yes, Mr. O'Brien, I was just wondering if you're going to check out today. And I'm like, oh, my God. I'm sorry. I forgot to tell you, but I'm going to stay an extra day if that's okay. She's like, yeah, I'm just going to put you on a brief hold, please. I'm like, all right. Comes back. She's like, yeah, sure. There's no problem. You can stay in the same room. Everything. I'm like, perfect. Cause I'm in no shape to leave this room. And she's like, well, what about your friend Scotty? Is he going to continue his stay? I'm like, no, he's a responsible adult with a beautiful baby girl. He has left the premises, but
but he left his sunglasses there in case you want to say.
Oh, I could have grabbed him. You didn't know I was there.
I didn't. I had no idea. In fact, when I texted you yesterday, you were like, I'm on the bird fella. Then I was like, he took a day.
He took a day. Up dog, our boy, Pekka Rinne, who, you know, just talk about the ceremony. And honestly, how about the videos of all the saves he made, like throughout his tenure as a Predator? Like they kept running the highlights. And I was like, every save he made was like so athletic and never out of a play. And the whole ceremony to the Nashville Predators organization, it was first class. It was something that they desperately needed. And what better guy than Pekka Rinne to start it off?
I love playing with Pek Sobes. You know, it's always so special when you leave the game and you get to experience some, inaugurations or these retirement things. And, you know, I think we were talking the one day, I don't think I've ever played with a guy, whose jersey's been retired on that respected team. Right. Like I've been trying to think and I just don't know if I have yet. So
yeah,
Pekka is my first teammate that, I grew up with. He's a year older than me. You know, I remember the first time Pex came to our team in Milwaukee and just tall, like super goofy, but like skilled.
Best
and
laugh.
Was competitive and wanted you to shoot the puck hard. He wanted you to shoot it high and hard. Like you get some goalies, you know, you fuck around and shoot one off the side of his leg and he's pissed. He like laughs about it. You know,
but he's Shea Weber, and he told the story about I think when PK got traded there and PK kind of was just doing probably what everyone else does and just kind of laid a muffin in there. And Pex is like, shoot the fucking thing.
Yeah.
Because Shea Weber, and I love Websy. It was so good to see Websy too. But he would fucking lean on these 105 mile an hour clappers from the ladies' tees. And I'm like, looking at Pex being like, you gotta start tomorrow. Like, if that hits you.
Yeah.
But he would just catch it. He'd catch it.
So it was just great, Obes. And it was nice that he had his family there and his little boy. And, you know, his little boy was a year and a half bouncing around.
Yeah.
And then, you know, just to see, like, the guys that came to support him. You know, Toots.
His Finnish buddies.
JP and all his Finnish buddies.
Oh, his Finnish buddies. These guys, it just brought me back to Hämeenlinna.
Yeah, yeah.
These Finnish guys, they're such great guys. Like, they're just so nice. They're so polite. And they just love to get pinned. You know what I mean? Like, they just love it.
Finnish guys. They're awesome. They love to get naked, get in the sauna, get pinned, and then go get more pinned.
Did you see the clip? I sent it to you. You probably didn't see it yesterday because you're probably busy, but there's an Instagram video. I told you after they won the gold medal that it's their two goalies, and all they do is got their goalie jock on, which is like a little bit bigger, so it covers their fucking horn, and they're just got the gold medal stark naked besides their jock on and just pinned in the dressing room.
So they're back in Finland?
No, this is right after the game.
In China. Oh, great.
Still just
drinking.
They get
pinned. Yeah.
Pinned.
Brings you back to the Spangy.
You think most people would maybe take the jock off and shower up, but not the Finns. They love being naked. They're like you. They love being naked. So
God bless them.
His people were so, his buddies were so amazing that we got to meet up in the alumni suite that they got for us. And thank you for that, Nashville. That was classy. But all great guys.
Kimmo Timonen. I haven't seen Kimmo forever. And when he walked in.
Oh, he was so happy to see you.
He had been doing TV work all day for the Preds, and you could tell he was ready to kind of let loose and have a drink.
He had already had a couple in him, I think.
He's like, when was the last time I saw you, Uppy? You know, and I'm like, fuck you, man. It's been a while. 5 years. Have a shot.
He just started laughing when we opened the door and saw you. He's like, ha, fucking Uppy. Yeah. Like, he was so excited to see you. And then you pulled me over right away, and I you know, obviously I was like, Kimmo, listen, man, I've been boys with Loops and Uppy forever, and these guys have said nothing but great things about you. Everybody that played with you in Nashville, honor to meet you, man. Within 5 minutes of hanging with them, I was like, I get what these boys are talking about. Like, laughing. We started talking about Teemu Selanne, and he loves playing. They both love playing tennis.
They're just machines.
I told Kimmo I like to play pickleball. He kind of looked at me like a pussy. You know, yeah. He's like, pickleball, really? I'm like, yeah, pickleball.
He did, but like just, the padel, though.
Just a great guy, man. Just a great guy.
He's a good dude. Lovely wife.
Sweetheart.
And you know what? Just witnessing how Nashville handled this whole thing. The fans were all there for Pex, you know, and then, when you said the highlights, like watching him. He was one of the best goalies of our era.
Oh, yeah.
Like, beyond. From his stick to, like, his pads to, like, fucking rolling over.
There was a play in game two against Vancouver. They pumped us in game one. We're hanging on 1-1 in game two just to bring her back to Smashville tied. And I got, I don't know who backdoor, but John Blummer, who's a fan of the pod, too. Yeah. Blummer, I don't know what the fuck you were doing or where you were going, Blummer. But you came over on my side, and I made kind of a shit play trying to... And, whoever sauces it backdoor. Blummer's on my side of the ice. I don't make a great play to try to deflect the pass. Backdoor, and Pex comes across and makes a fucking pad save. We end up winning that game in overtime to tie up the series. Like, I forgot how big of a save that was.
Wow, good memory.
Well, I didn't know until I saw the clip.
Oh, you
get serious. And I was like,
shit.
Yeah. I was like, uh-oh, 55. I'm like, and here we go. But, I mean, it was amazing. Pekka Rinne, congratulations. He's such a great guy, Uppy. His Finnish buddies were awesome. Everybody was awesome. And speaking about awesome, Jordan Tutu. We have a podcast coming of Toots. We're not sure when we're going to release it just yet because it's evergreen, right?
Yeah.
Evergreen. I learned a new fucking saying in the content world. Evergreen.
Yeah, it's evergreen.
So you don't like say the date. You don't say what you're doing. You don't say.
It's
but anyways.
Such
but
a
when
great...
you tell everyone when we recorded it kind of takes
Does
away.
Does that affect the evergreen?
It's not so ever.
Well, when they see we're at the tin roof, too, they're going to know.
It's never green. No, it's never green.
Yeah, well, I fucked up the evergreen, but we don't know when we're going to release it. But just hanging out with them. The podcast was like, I looked to Maxie after, and Maxie's like, man, that was heavy. It was so, what's the word?
Just real.
Yeah.
It was real. It was honest.
I hadn't seen Toots really hung out with Toots since I played with him, since he went through all that. I was right there at the very end, which we get into. But to see how happy he is. To see how clear he is in his eyes, to see how comfortable he is in his own skin with everything that he went through. Man, when I played with Toots, he was always worried about, you know, hey, don't tell anyone this, you know, this and that, can't find out. Now he's just like, I'll talk about anything. So it was great to see him. I know you were a lot closer than him than I was, but for me to talk to him and hang out with him, his beautiful wife, Jen, it was refreshing, Uppy.
Yeah, no, I love hanging out with Jen. I love hanging out with Toots. Every time I see him, it brings me back. I think he brings out a side of me, man, that that is a very good side. It's a side that, you know, it takes me back to being younger with them. We've been through battle. We've been through ups and downs as friends. And, you know, he's always been there for me, vice versa. But, you know, it's a great podcast, like you just said. And we're excited to have that and for him to give us that opportunity. And then, you know, he's such an amazing guy, and he's so giving to his community, to the Aboriginal community. He travels and speaks to kids upon kids. You know, his book, Go All the Way, if anyone's never read this book, it's a must read, and it'd actually be a great read before you listen to our podcast. So, you know, Toots, yeah, he's a special human, man, and very, very powerful dude.
Yeah, Toots, love you, buddy. Speaking of a special human, Brendan Walker. Woxy. He's another special human, man. That was just so great. I once again, only 1 year with Woxy, but the way he treated the players when he was there, the way he took care of the boys on the road, it was just awesome to hang out with him. It was awesome to hang out with him at the 12:30 club. Fuck after
he got that city dialed in.
He's just a great guy. I mean, he's just a guy that knows how to do his job, respects the players, and then the players respect him back. And there's not one guy, current player, former Preds, alumni, whatever, that doesn't love Walks. So Walks, it was great to see you. We'll be back in a couple weeks. But what a just a national leaguer.
Yeah, national leaguer. And I mean, when I first got to that team, Walks was this super chubby, unlike
court. Yeah, I heard like, he was chubby.
He was chubby. Red hair, but you could tell as a young guy, he was driven to like help the guys. Yeah. And that position in sports and for sports teams, It goes unthanked. A lot of guys take a guy like Brendan Walker for granted, but totally. There's only a certain few that can handle that job and do it as good as him. And what he, you know, he helped us out this week. He you know, he's always dialed us in. He hits me up numerous times throughout the season to ask about, you know, new restaurants on the road and where should I send the guys. So he's always looking out for his players. But, you know, got a chance to hang with him. And then shout out to Roman Yossi, whose restaurant right across the street, 1230 Club, is quite the
spot. I wish that was there when I played.
That's
there.
A nice little touch. The Apple Store, Shake Shack.
I turned to Webbs. I was just fucking hammered. I turned to Webbs. I said, hey, you were a great captain, but how come you didn't have this establishment for the boys back in the day? Hey, this would have been all right for the lads.
Yeah, that's a sweet spot.
Oh, my God. It's got like a private little.
Yeah, Justin Timberlake's bar, right? So JT started it, got some investors.
I'm going to call it Roman Yoshi's bar still, even though.
Yeah. Dialed in that second room, didn't he? The young guys in Nashville look like they're having a good time.
Ryan Johansson, great guy.
Great guy.
Came up, talked to me, said, oh, but you know I'm from Vancouver. I said, of course I know I'm from Vancouver. I just want to let you know, like I always, like, you're a beauty. I always, like, you know, wish I would have played with you or something. Or he had some nice things to say that he didn't have to say. He's a big boy. I didn't know he was as tall as he was.
He is. He is a big boy.
He's a good BC lad. Walks, thanks for everything. David Leguan, too. Leggy makes the old, I'm taking the private bird in on Saturday, and I'm leaving Saturday night. So, which means he made too much fucking money. Leggy, which he did, but it was good to see Leggy. He stopped in and said hi to the boys. But Updog, the whole thing, congratulations to Pekka Rinne. Nashville Predators, good on you. Everybody, it was a great ceremony. The first of many for the Preds. Who's next? Webbs?
Webbs, yes. Close, yeah. Webbs still has 4 years on his contract, but...
You can't retire someone's jersey till they retire officially, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, and Webb's, you know, I wish him the best because I know how injuries can, you know, linger and affect you long term. So, you know, wishing the best for him. But, whether he ever comes back or not, he's got 4 more years as a Montreal Canadian. So I think Nashville probably respectfully will just wait.
I would say, I don't know what goes into jersey retirements. I was never sniffing it. But if you're going off by the reception that he got when he came out for Pexes, I would say, hey, to the ownership and Dave, that's probably a pretty good indication that the fans of Nashville wanted up there. So.
I think, and he wants to stay in hockey. You know, I think I had a conversation with him, but he'd be a great GM. He's still very, I was talking to him about some of the moves Montreal has made and, you know, the progress there. They've obviously not having a great year, but...
Well, he's Marty St. Louis got him buzzing.
Buzzing, Jake Muzzin.
Buzzing, which we're going to get into.
Yeah, so, no, he wants to be around the game.
Yeah, you know, and he's just a pro.
So Nashville, maybe he takes over for Poile one day.
I don't know if Poile's going anywhere. Fucking guy. I don't think he's ever retired.
Eventually he's going to have to.
Thank you to everyone. Pekka Rinne, congratulations. Updog, our first segment is brought to you by our friends at DraftKings. thank you to them again for a great weekend, a great setup. It's just called Stadium Series. First of all, shout out to current Preds, Matt Luff. We're in the Nashville Predators locker room, and he comes in after practice and just gives the boys the old fella tour.
The fella tour.
And I don't, I'm like, fuck up. Like, I knew, like, you know, beauties from back home listen to it, and beauties around here, and guys that drink too much listen to it. But, like, you know, guys like us. But, like, to have a current National Leaguer come in and say fella tour, it fucking made my day. I got to have a few with them at the 1230 club after I saw him. I said, I think I did another shot of Jager with them, by the way.
You got to have Jaeger as a sponsor after this weekend.
Well, yeah, he polished off at least, not half. I would say almost half of that 2.6 during our live show. That was just to keep warm.
Fuck, you should have had a couple. I put my arm around you.
I was freezing.
You were fucking shaking like a leaf.
Buddy, to be on, it was crazy. I the whole weekend, I don't know why I didn't get sick.
I never worried about you underpacking, to be honest with you. But to Matt Luff, man, that was unbelievable.
Yeah, nice the boys are recognizing the fella tour today.
It was great. And, like, it was so cool to go down in the Preds dressing room and then hang out outside the Tampa Bay dressing room. And John Cooper, who we love, Big Rig, Corey Perry. And then we got, you know, walks in the Nashville room, Roman Yossi, Matt Duchene, our old equipment guy, Pete.
Yeah, Pete Rogers.
Pete Rogers, great guy. I didn't see Partner. That's my only
downfall.
I didn't
see Partner, but he was there.
Where the fuck
I asked, was so he? I chatted with Coach Hines for a bit after the game.
Yeah.
Great guy and you know, I had a lot of insight onto, you know, their team. And I asked him, I'm like, Partner around? Now where's that? Hell yeah, he's around. He's still doing, you know, he's still being Partner, and he's...
Well, I didn't
still
see
giving
him.
Those
I'm
big hugs that cracks absolutely every part of your spine.
Yeah, he's a fucking strong guy.
Yeah, he's the man, our boy Partner. Tomasino's a good kid, too. Yeah. Did you get the chance to talk to that young kid?
I got to
young
talk
kid
to
from Toronto. He's
Saros.
Only...
I got to talk to Saros for a bit. Saros
you
comes,
did.
Saros comes by me. He's like, hey, HPK, Hamelina.
Yeah, he's
and
from
I'm like,
there.
Yeah, yeah. I'm like, what? He's like, you play HPK? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, you play there? He's like, it's my hometown. I'm like, so he was probably in junior.
Yeah.
When I was playing there.
Yeah, of course. You're the NHLer
he was probably
coming
like, look
in.
At this fucking fat fuck coming over here to play for Hamelina. I was so out of shape.
No, he's probably looking up to you like, hey, this guy's a baller.
I had a great chat with him. I had a great chat with him just about Hamelina, about him growing up, about how he's doing now. He also said he's a fan of the stuff we do. I'm not sure he's listening to everyone, but he knows we're out there doing our stuff. But it was cool to hang out with him. And Uppy, you talk about, you know, you miss the game a lot, and I downplay, you know, I don't miss it really, and I don't miss playing, but to be down there around the room again, I felt like I was home, bro. I had this conversation with Jim Abbott in the pool this morning, because Jim just did, he did the innings festival in Arizona, which they usually do for spring training. But
yeah,
because,
my money jacket was going to go there, right?
Yeah, because Binger's Dodgers fucking want more money, hey? They're not playing. Just joking, I'm always on the player side. Owners, come on now. But he went there and he said the same thing. Like he was like, it was so nice to be back with ball players. I'm like, dude, me and Uppy just had the privilege of being down there. Thank you to the NHL for including us in that. It was so much fun, Uppy. I missed the locker room, man.
I know. No, when you say like, do you miss the game? Man, my answer is a quick yes. Like I miss a lot of things about it. There's, you know, certain few obvious ones that I don't.
Like curfew.
Yeah. Or the sting. Yeah. But it's where home was for us forever.
Oh,
it's where, like, you know, you had battles and you know, you made friendships and, you know, you tell stories and you sit in there and tape your stick and get fucking dressed up, ready to fucking go. You know, it's everything. It's nice to see him walk in as, you know, you're in the show, bro.
It was nice to be down in the locker room too and not worry about a coach coming over and be like, hey, O'Brien, did you weigh in yet?
Yeah.
Hey, did you weigh in yet? Yeah, I'll fucking weigh in, coach. Lay off me here. I'll weigh in.
Yeah,
but
I was never on the way in program.
No, I know. It was nice. It was really, really nice. So thank you again. And then Updog, the outfits to the outdoor game. The Lightning would go with the Canadian tuxedos, which was unbelievable. I mean, I saw the Big Rig.
Corey Perry looked great.
Pears had those jeans were just so, like, just nut huggers.
Seeing him at Tootsie's after, too. He still had them rocking. Oh, my guy's got to be chafing.
Yeah, I said to the Big Rig... we went out with the boys after. I said, how are those feeling, buddy? You didn't want to go home and throw out a pair of Lululemons or something? He said, no, I'm going all in tonight. So that, and then obviously Nashville killed it.
Travis Austin.
Yeah, they killed it.
Travis Austin, I think their fans should maybe look at this guy's stuff.
Yeah.
If you like that swagger with that, like, leather jacket, raw, fucking sick hat look. You know, you get the personalized hat. There's a couple guys in Aspen doing that, but this Travis Austin, boy, did
they
look dialed.
I thought the Canadian tuxedo was hilarious.
Yeah.
Right? Like two-time Stanley Cup champ, Stammer says, let's bring out the fucking Canadian tuxedos, and they killed it. Yeah. But if you're talking like looking cool, like New Age National League, the Preds with the leather jackets and those lids.
Smash it. Personalized leather coats, each one, and personalized hats.
At that 1230 club, I was just pinned enough to forget that they all wore it, and I was like looking around, I'm like, this whole team's got sick style. Yeah. This whole fucking
team. You've been all black leather. I'm like, I've been
wearing leather jackets my whole career. Everyone's making fun of me. This whole team's wearing black leather jackets. And I'm like, oh, they wore them to the game, dummy. But yeah, they looked good.
Definitely, definitely. Well done, boys.
Yeah, congratulations. Yeah, well done. I mean, an Updog, we talk about the stadium series a lot. You were lucky enough to play in the Winter Classic. I never played in one, nor did I really want to. I'm still not sold on a TV. I still think the NHL needs to figure out a made-for-TV spectacle. But what a live event. The way it looked in Nashville, to the fans of Nashville, 70,000 in there.
Nuts.
And to Tampa fans, which I got next in our rundown here. But one thing I didn't know about these games live is how much they pump the microphone and the play. You can hear the skates. You can hear the puck. You can hear the hits. I mean, me and Maxie were in the draft, and it was pounding up there. And it made, to me, Uppy, it made a huge difference for these fans.
Yeah,
and for me as a fan.
No, I know. And that sort of technology has been, you know, they hang the things, Obi, in the corners in a normal rink. And I think that elevates, like, the experience for a fan. I think that's why one of many things that makes hockey exciting is the sounds, right?
Fuck, it sounded so good.
But you, if you did not have those speakers and they played, you know, at center field and you're sitting in one of those suites or you're sitting anywhere in the crowd, you wouldn't hear nothing.
And that's kind of what I thought it was like. Like, I knew they'd have little mic, but I didn't know it would. And I wonder if the rest of them been like that or if Nashville just killed it like everything else. But it was loud, Uppy.
You know what? I remember in ours when we played our Winter Classic, like while you're on the ice as a player, you cannot hear anything.
Yeah.
It's just you guys. It's actually very, very quiet. No matter if there's Dierks Bentley behind you playing or the fans after a goal screaming, like it's almost like this, you know, barrier.
Because they're so far away.
They're so far away.
Yeah,
it's far. It's
that's
like
crazy.
So as soon as they start, you know, the speed of sound, but they cheer, it's like a second before it gets to you. It's a weird, like, kind of dynamic.
Yeah, you make a good player. Like, how come the crowd didn't like that? Oh, yeah, there we go.
They're cheering. They just can't hear them.
Yeah.
You know, and then, but you're right. These speakers, and we walked there to do our interviews the day before after practice. Those speakers, you know, those things that get the they'll get the party rocking. Those are just faced right into the crowd. Yeah, it makes it good. You hear the swears, you hear the slap shots.
I was blown away. I thought it looked. We were lucky too, where we had our DraftKings. Thanks again to them. The suite was sick. The way it sounded, the way it looked, I just think those speakers made such a huge difference to me. I was blown away. I think it's a great live event. So good on the NHL. I still think, you know, it's not great on television, but Lightning fans, I'm a former Tampa Bay Lightning Updog. We were walking down Broadway. They were everywhere. I don't know. It's awesome. Obviously, to win back-to-back Stanley Cup helps, but for them to come to Nashville, represent that jersey, the city, the organization, they were everywhere. They were getting banged up. They were having a good time. So it brought a little, as a former guy there, to see where they've come. They've always had great fans, but man, they were everywhere, Ups.
Everywhere. And that, if you're going to talk about just the support that they're getting, I mean, like you said, pipe dream 6-7 years ago, or when we played, that Nashville would have a fan base like that. And I recall like witnessing these yellow jerseys at one point and be like, what the hell are they doing wearing mustard jerseys, right? But, you know, this was explained, I think, numerous times, but Sully mentioned it and
yeah,
stuff.
So
back in the day.
My last year was the last year of the blue and
blue.
Gray. So I remember our season ended and they showed us, they're like, these are our colors next year. We're wearing, they didn't wear gold helmets right away. They wore the gold with the blue helmets to start. But we were all like,
But they would say like Detroit comes into town or Montreal comes into town or any other visiting team comes in and we're just wearing these like blue colored jerseys. Our seats are blue.
Yeah.
We can't take over like and have a brand, right? It's just, it's not the right look. We want to flood this place with like disgusting mustard. And sure enough, they did. And the support that you see people walking around.
Disgusting mustard.
It's not Dijon.
They're gold, aren't they?
Do you think the jerseys are gold or they're
mustard
color?
I don't know. I'm asking. I don't know. I don't know.
Gold is like the Notre Dame.
I love gold. Yeah, they're like a yellow. You're right.
They're just disgusting yellow. But it works because now they actually have the. You see that color jersey, you immediately think of no one else but the Nashville Predators, yeah. And that was what they were going for.
And their barn, the Knight of Pexis, it was just yellow or gold everywhere. Yeah. It was awesome. Yeah, they're yellow. You're right. They're yellow. But it's right. That's what they did. Because when I played there, when the Wings would come to town, it would be, you could see more red almost than blue. So.
Yeah, of course.
Up dogger boy, Walker Hayes. I mean, listen, guy. That was a great guy. To see them warming up. Well, I mean,
I was shaking. I was trying to do the jumping jacks with them.
Yeah.
But I was freezing, bro.
How cool was that for us to go out there and do that?
Yeah, it was wild. I'm happy for you. That was great. I'm happy for us. It was like I got to tell you, I was nervous, but I tried to keep it together because I knew you were a little nervous too.
I was nervous. Yeah. I had just enough glow going though that I was like, I got this.
Do you remember what you said to me when we got off about being a rock star?
No.
You're like, fuck up, dog. I got an itch now to be a rock star. I never really had that before. Now I'm up there and I'm like.
When me and you were up there and I looked out and I've always wondered, like I've been side stage.
Just to see a beauty, sir.
Just to be up there and imagine being Walker Hayes and coming out. It's like. Fuck, it's got to be. Imagine being Pearl Jam.
Just girls just launching their.
Yeah, but imagine being any better coming up there, not like at Juana Fest. People's far as you can see.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'd never been in that position. I was like, whoa.
Yeah.
Now, one of these guys get all these chicks, eh?
No kidding.
But I mean, right in front of you. When you play, unless you look up, you don't even really know.
No, you're so involved in the moment and the heat of it. But like when you speak to the crowd like that, like when you're, you know, even him, like, hey, Nashville.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming to my show. You know, like, and he's like, we're going to play some tunes for you guys. I hope you're, you know, even just speaking to them like that, like you can fuck shit up easy.
Yeah.
You know, you miss a chord, fucking guitar string breaks. You're like, shit, I dropped my pick. The drummer's fucking drunk back there. He's not playing the right song. A lot can go wrong up there.
And I was just like, honestly, all I was thinking was don't fall.
Were you?
Yeah, like don't trip over the drum set.
I was just launching those rubber pucks.
Did you put my nut on your drum? Are you fucking crazy, man? Hey, I was just like, don't trip on a fucking.
Yeah, totally.
Right? And like next thing you know, O'Brien was down at Walker Hayes. I don't know.
Yeah. So I was. You did get down on one knee, though.
At the end, I said, Walker Hayes. Yeah.
It was nice to say.
It was nice when you started throwing the rubber, the foam pucks out. The DraftKings Missing Curfew foam pucks.
Yeah.
Fans loved it.
Loved it.
People love free shit. Doesn't matter what it is.
Trying to hit everybody. Trying to hit all the Lightning fans.
There was lots.
There was tons.
It was good because we got them.
They travel well. Well, fuck. They won back to back. You'd think they'd travel well now.
So if there's any bands out there that are looking for people to introduce them, hit us up at missingcurfew.com. We are, right?
We're band hitter uppers.
You know, Walker, if he wants to go on tour with us, let us know, fella. DraftKings live show. Uppy. Thanks to Maxi. Maxi, great work, buddy.
It was great, Max. Yeah, great job, Max.
DraftKings, thank you for the setup. And then the guys that came on, Sully, JP Dumont, Big Sutsy, Toots, Leggy,
Lindsay L.
And then other Lindsay too. She was a sweetheart.
Yeah, Lindsay. Yeah. Lindsay.
Rowley.
Lindsay Rowley. Lindsay L was so cool to talk to. She was our second, right? JP slid in, then she came in. Yeah, she's cool.
Cool.
Great shades.
She had great shades.
I should leave those shades on.
She had good Nikes on.
Great Nikes.
She's hot.
Good Canadian girl. She is hot.
Yeah, she's hot.
The picture I had up of her with her little, I think it might have been a Wikipedia page or something.
She's got some really great action shots of her playing the guitar, like down on her. And Jimi Hendrix, she said Jimi, her dog's name is Jimi Hendrix, Hendrix.
Yeah.
But she's got the pictures where she's on her knees, laid back with the guitar up. Like, I almost fell over there.
Your buddy got a conky there. Clean up aisle three here, eh? That's the last thing we need at Missing Curfew right now.
Perfect.
We're already in one. But there was one of her on her knee. Badass.
Did you catch a show with Chase Beckham?
She was a sweetheart. She killed it, though. Second, third intermission. She came out, strummed it. So the Stadium Series, great job, Nashville. Great job, DraftKings. Everybody involved. To the players, it was a great hockey game. Hey, Maxie, we had the old first period under that hit, but you didn't. Maxie had the over and Nashville.
The first period over, the game we over, had the and opposite. Nashville. Yeah, I lost everything.
I had Tampa and the first period under. What did you have there on your DraftKings app?
I had a smorgasbord.
No, but tell the people. You're doing a lot of these shot props, right?
I was doing, oh, man. Yeah, the individual shot props on the DraftKings app.
If I took away, you were just all weekend.
2.5 shots over Braden Point. It was like, minus one, whatever, 50.
Yeah.
I had the green check mark on that after like 7 minutes. Feels good. He just one shift. Boom, boom, boom.
One power play.
And then I took Victor Hedman to get a power play point. So over 0.5 points, Victor Hedman. That was giving me great odds, actually. That was like plus 400. I put a lot of money on it. I made a lot of money on that. Wow. Then I had Stammer with that fucking 1T city. I had him over three shots. Check mark. Nice goal. Check mark. And then I did lose out. You know what I had? Oh, my God. And I almost hit it. So I took both teams to win by two. The odds were just great on both sides. I thought, you know what? It's a close game. Someone pulls their goalie.
You're hoping for an empty netter.
Okay, so I had the Lightning and the Preds. Lightning go up two, mid-third. Forsberg scores on the peeper. Now it's one goal game. And I'm thinking, and I told Webby, I was watching the game with Webbs, and I was like, this is going to be good. Like, this is like plus 4,000. Like, you know, it's like put down 200, win fucking, I don't know, four grand. Like,
wow.
It was good odds. Probably win, no, put down 200, win 1,400. And sure as shit, man, it was so close. But the Preds, like, they kept the pressure on them, and then a little scrum at the end. It was great. Good fights and good scrums. Our boy Patty Maroon, yeah.
Great tilt.
Great games. Yeah.
There was two fights. I was like, get the boys playing outside all the time here. Two fights. So it was a great weekend. So thank you for DraftKings for making that happen for us. Our next segment is brought to you by our good friends at Candidip Lip Boomers.
Boomskis.
Promo code?
Curfew, Cali.
It's just called good old-fashioned locker room chatter. It's locker room chatter up, dog. We got
chit-chat.
We got a lot of chatter over the weekend, and there were some stories that came out of the weekend that involved... There's two that involved you and one of me, so let's get yours first. What was your trainer's name in
Dougie,
Milwaukee?
Doug Agnew.
So to tee everybody up here, our listeners that don't know what a Z-Pack is... A Z-Pack is what we call a good old-fashioned oil change, all right? You got to take the car in every fucking 2,000 miles, right? Well, after the road trip in the jungle or in the America or in the NHL, sometimes you got to take the body in for a little oil change. So take it from there.
So Dougie, yeah, Toots had to remind him. He's like, Doug, I got to tell you this story. Like, one day you came in, and you've never called a team meeting ever before. But we're in Milwaukee, and we were just running hard, and you came in the room, and you said... Guys, enough's enough. Six of you have been in my office this morning after this road trip asking for Z-Packs. He's like, have none of you ever seen a fucking condom before? And he took a box of condoms and just threw them on the ground.
Just and we're threw all them like, in the middle of the room.
We're all like,
use these fucking things, would you?
We're looking around. We're like, who are the six guys, eh?
Oh, no, yeah. Fuck. Who knew? I mean, I could guess. If they show me the roster, I could guess who they were. I know you and Tutu were two of them. But when he told that story, he's such a great guy too. Doug, what story?
Yeah, Doug Agnew. After 30 years in the minors, he's now. No, this is great too.
When he's walking by the sticks, you're like, "Hey, Doug, you want me to give you a hand here, buddy?"
He used to be our athletic trainer, and you know he was fucking doing this. He was putting bags. You know what it's like in the minors. You put bags on the bus. You're carrying the sticks. You got your own stuff. You're trying to give guys ice bags after games. It's a lot on the trainers, man. Late
it's a lot on the players, too. You got to carry your bags.
30 years of that. 30 years. So then finally, he's up in the show. He gets called up in the show. Yeah.
Wow.
And, you know, what do I see him doing? First thing, carrying fucking sticks. So I get underneath the sticks of them. I'm like, Dougie, I got these.
You're like, Dougie, you want me to help you out here, bud?
Yeah.
I was dying. But when he's like, tells the story, he comes in with a handful of condoms and throws them in the middle of the room. You fucking boys know how to use these or what? Oh, it was great. I was in tears. And then Todd Moose Richards.
Todd Richards, our assistant
Todd
coach.
Richards, he great
was our
guy.
Assistant coach in Milwaukee. I always great remember guy. Him. My first time I ever got called up, he took it in our, you know, he's big pool guy. Not swimming pool, like, but you want to get the Masters pool going.
Oh, yeah.
So my first year
I
pro,
get a couple
he,
pools going here at Mr. Curfew.
I got called up, and I was living with Hammer, Hammies.
Nicest guy in the world,
nice
probably.
Nice guy, yeah. Super nice guy. Him
Does
and
he even swear?
No, anyway, he's not much of a swear.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Kind of like me.
Big biker, though.
Good shape, lean.
He really does mountain bike races, and he's badass. He's strong like fucking, like an animal.
Strong like bull.
So Moose was like, oh, you're like, I don't know. Tell me a story about a young updog.
He comes over and he's like, hey, boys, how you doing there? Good to see you again. We first saw him after practice, and then we saw him again. No. We saw him, the first night after Pex's ceremony. And he came over. He's like, fucking Uppy. He was so happy to see you. He's like, fucking Uppy. Great to see you. And I thought it was his brother. What's his brother's name?
His brother was Travis Richards.
Yeah, coached in Grand Rapids or something, right? So I came over and introduced myself. He's like, no, it's my brother. So then you and him started shooting the shit. And he was just loving it. He was so happy to see you. And then he kind of just kept going and going. And he's like.
Then he laughs and he's like, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, he's like. Who's your head coach there, Claude?
Claude Lemieux. Pepe. Claude Noel.
So I was like, what was it like, coach the young updog, eh? He's like, holy fuck. He's like, me and Claude every morning. We had meetings every morning about Uppy.
What are we going to do with this kid? Me and Claude
were like, what are we going to do with this fucking upshot? And I was like, oh, you weren't talking about the neutral zone forechecker. The guy's like, no, we're like, how the fuck are we going to control this upshot?
Claude would look at him and be like, what are we going to do with upshot? And he's like, I don't know. I'm coaching the D, and it's my first year of a coach. What am I supposed to say to him?
He's like, I'm a first year coach. And they're like, this kid's a fucking sixth overall pick here. We got to fucking, like, we got to get him to the league. Like, he just wants to fuck everything. Like, what are we gonna... And he's telling this story. And I'm like, every morning, he's like, if he wasn't up at the big club, every morning it was on our list of things. How are we going to control Uppy today? Or what are we going to do with this upshot? And when he told that story, oh, I fucking just about hit the ground. He's a great guy. Great guy.
I wonder who was ratting me out. Where's one of my teammates?
No, I think Uppy, we just had to realize that we weren't fooling anybody.
No, not a chance.
We thought we were.
Yeah.
Nah, we weren't fooling it.
Like, if I was a coach now, I'd know each guy what they're doing.
Before the evening.
And I want to do it with them.
Yeah. But that's our thing. We'd be like, boys, where are you going? Don't worry. I won't tell anyone. You don't tell on me, eh? Don't tell the coach on me. But remember the old Flexol trick? No, the old Vicks vapor rub trick?
Yeah, to hide the hangover. Didn't work.
I think it was probably more of a heat score than anything.
Yeah, double bubble.
Todd Richards, you're a beauty. That story, it made my trip. And then Dave Poyle. We bumped into Dave Poyle, and you were talking to him. You're like, hey, oh, here's Dave. And I was like, oh, yeah, Dave. And I went over to shake his hand, and I was like, hey, Dave, nice to see you. He's like, hey, Obi, nice to see you. He's like, actually, it's nice to see you not in my office for once. And I was like, yeah, I only played here for a year with you, and I was in his office like 7 times. I come in the rank, they'll be like, Dave wants to see you. I'm like, what? We've won 4 straight.
Totally.
Our penalty kill's 5th in the league. What did I do now? Call me in. I heard you're at... losers last night, you know, drinking heavily, you know, girls, you know, I'm like, is that against the rules, Dave?
Yeah. No,
but anyways, he called me in about 7 times. So I thought, I thought that was,
7 times.
I think it was 5 or 6 times. I'm not lying.
Really?
It was, let's keep the over under DraftKings over under at 5. It was close.
Wow.
Yeah.
For 1 year.
1 year.
That's crazy.
And we were good.
I know.
Imagine we were bad.
They had eyes everywhere.
My saving grace was our penalty kill.
I put the tracker on you, bud.
No, our penalty kill was top 5. Me and Kleiner, Suits and Webbs.
So I knew
they weren't going to fuck with the penalty kill. I knew I was all right, as long as I didn't drive into a telephone pole or something. Like I knew I was going to be okay. But like, they knew everything, and that's probably what might be like cool about playing in Nashville now. They probably don't know everything. Like when we were there, especially when you were there.
I know.
It was a little bit bigger. Yeah. When you were there, they knew every time you went to the Tin Roof and took a piss. They're like, Upshaw took 7 pisses last night at the Tin Roof. Like
in the drain. Yeah. No, I know. It's crazy. They knew everything.
Everything.
And then Trotsky let you know that the day you got there.
Yeah, Trotsky told me, slow the fuck down. He said, what did I tell you when you first got here? I'm like, be a good team guy. You know, penalty kill, stick up for our teammates, be good in the room. He's like, no, not about hockey, about Nashville. I'm like, I don't know what. He's like, it's a small town. Slow the fuck down. And I'm like, oh boy. Anyways, locker room chatter. Updog, those stories about you were unbelievable. Dave Poyle, it was good to see you, Dave. Updog, Marty St. Louis.
Whew.
We've talked about him. You know, you made a great point last week, I think, or the week before. I can't remember because the fella two are here. All I know is February was a blur, eh, boys? I know there's only 28 days, Maxie, but how is that February?
The longest 28 days.
I woke up, I was like, wow, it's March 1st. Where the
Yeah, no kidding. That felt good.
Yeah, no, it's been great. Marty,
it's expensive, but
the Habs have won 5 straight. Cole Caulfield playing his best hockey of the year. I saw Jeff Petrie saying something last night in a press conference after the game. Marty's making it fun to come to the rink. And this is why you want guys that have been in the trenches, that have, you know, Marty's won a Stanley Cup, a gold Olympic gold medal. I mean, probably more and more. I don't have his things up here. But when you can bring a Marty St. Louis into your dressing room, and Marty was one of the best teammates. I knew Uppy. I didn't know. I, I didn't know he would, you know, get the win in five in a row and playing some really good hockey, but I knew he would make a difference, Ops.
I had him at World Championships, and he was awesome.
Yeah.
And he was great. He invited, I remember golfing with him and me and my brother, and he was like, you could tell, driven, loved the young guys. But man, five in a row for the Montreal Canadiens?
Right, five now? Straight here.
Heads up.
And I bet him for the first time on my DraftKings app.
And?
They won. They were the first time all year they weren't.
Are they scoring? They getting good goaltending.
They're
scoring.
They're fucking. They're doing it all,
they're
man.
Just fucking.
They're doing it all. Colefield's like on fire. They're playing great hockey. Marty St. Louis. I mean, it was the first time all year they weren't an underdog at home against Buffalo. And I took them and they worked them.
What do you think? What do these guys do at the deadline now?
They trade everyone. They're still that far out. I got the standings right here. Yeah, they still got 33 points. I mean, they're eighth in the Atlantic.
Is our boy Edmondson back yet?
He's skating good. He had a regular jersey on. He's coming back. He's ready to come back, I think, Ups. But Cole Caulfield now, he's got 18 points. Josh Anderson's been playing a lot better. Now there's a guy that maybe he's got lots of term left. I wouldn't trade him, but I'm sure there's
He's two. A gamer though, right?
Gamer, so and I love him.
Mike Hoffman, trade him.
Hoffman shouldn't have signed him. But yeah, congrats to Marty Updog. And you were right. I think it was just bring him in for maybe this second half or the second half and see as it goes, but I don't think he's going anywhere. So Marty, keep it going. Updog, another guy that's been in the news. He's a content creator like ourselves, and fuck, is he good at creating content. His cameos are great. Aves goes to the Orlando Solar Bears for a little PTO. His video is unbelievable. He came out, he's like, well, listen, you know what? 3 days, loved it. Bag skated me, loved it. Wanted more of it. He's like, I just missed my little guy Nasher too much. And then his first video of when he's outside the hotel, he's like, yeah, well, you know what? Going to get some shut-eye. Get the legs going.
Then I'm going to go
tomorrow.
Chase some pucks.
Yeah. Hungry on pucks. Did you talk to him at all? It was great. It was great content.
It was awesome. I knew it exactly what it was too. There's no way a guy in his, you know, fucking his setup that he's going to want to leave LA with his family to go play and muck it up in the minors and have everyone trying to fucking go after his head.
Right.
But I think it was a great opportunity for a guy to kind of get out there again and fuck, see if he did like it. Maybe he did. It was a chance. Maybe he was like, fuck, I still got this. And then maybe he thought one or two games here, go to the A.
Yeah.
Hey, go to the A.
I would have liked to see him play in a game.
Yeah, he didn't even get one, did he?
I think he just probably decided, I miss my kid. I miss my wife. I miss my life.
Yeah.
But there would have been some punk. Some little punk in the fucking East Coast League that said I had an opportunity to fight Sean Avery, knowing that it would go probably viral. I don't even know what viral is, but go, you know, viral on the internet.
Break the internet.
Yeah. So maybe that's why Aves didn't want to do it, because he didn't want to fight. But knowing Avery, he probably wanted to pump somebody.
So
like,
and then,
Barnaby and LaRock. Did you see his video about Barnaby and LaRock?
I did. And I think someone would have maybe signed those two mutants to go in there.
I think we should try to set up a Barnaby Avery pay-per-view sponsored by DraftKings.
Right on the center ice at T-Mobile.
Yeah, how much would it cost to get Avery to do it, though? Avery's is big, pricey.
I don't know. Maybe
back and forth forever.
What would you do? How would you organize like hockey fights like for pay-per-view, you think?
They'd be better off to do like a boxing fight.
Do you do rounds? Like two rounds, and if you fall, that's like a round?
Do you remember that? They had that in Canada.
Fucking just ice blades and shit. Man, you got to put on gloves a bit, though. You probably have to wear the UFC gloves. Just if you're going to have rounds, you can't just fucking continue to bump each other.
I think Aves would probably like to get him in a boxing ring because Aves is in great shape.
He runs
the fucking, what's the hill there in LA?
Runyon.
Yeah, thank you.
Does he run Runyon?
He runs around where he lives there. He lives near Runyon. He runs it.
That's fucking, I haven't been running shit. Been dancing a lot.
Been swimming. Yeah, doing two-stepping. So, Aves, you're great at content, buddy. It was good to see you back. I would like to see you play one game, see if you can still, you know, throw the sauce out there. But it was great. Uppy, Corey Perry, 400 goals.
Wow.
Got to bump into, hang out with Perry. It was great to see Pears, former Hart Trophy winner. 400 goals, though. Good for him. He's still going. He's got 17 tucks. 17 or 14?
When we had talked to Coop and he looked at us, he went, Hall of Famer? Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Right? Like
100%. That was great. See, that's why Coop's such a beauty. Pears got 14 goals.
14 snipes.
Because that's just like a conversation you have with your buddies. Like, We interviewed John Cooper too. Can I say that, or is that against Evergreen too?
No, you can say that.
I love John. No,
that
Cooper.
Was all over. We showed that we had Toots and Coop.
When Coop sits down at Tin Roof, and the first thing he says, I bring up Corey Perry. He's like, Hall of Famer? Hall of Famer?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, just like all the boys.
Yeah.
14 goals, Pair's got, and he hadn't scored his first one for like 10 games.
Took him 10.
He's playing great.
He's been mucking.
Killhorn's a beauty too. We got to talk to Killhorn, Killer. Great to see Stammer. Kucherov, first guy off the ice. I loved it. Hey, practice and see you later, Kuchy. I'm out of there. Love it. And the big rig. Their whole team. Ryan McDonough's a great guy. Bogosian's coming back. Cal Foote, I got to talk to him.
Yeah, Adam I saw Foote's him at the. I saw him at Tootsie's. Yeah,
great guy.
He was mixing. Great guy. A couple beers with Adam Foote. Guy's a legend.
Adam Foote, he's a beauty.
Fuck.
His nose is crooker than mine.
Yeah, it is.
He's a great guy though, Footer. I he used played to see the him game
hard.
Hard. Are you kidding me? Congrats, Pairs. Friend of the pod, Matty Tkachuk, have an unbelievable season. 400 games in the National League.
400.
He gets his NHLPA jacket.
The fucking leather jacket with a little stitching in the middle.
Pitter's got mine. Pitter, you still got that?
I don't have one. That's fucking. Maybe my dad's got it.
Pitter's got mine.
Fuck. They weren't sending us shit in Phoenix when I got it.
But that's awesome, Matty. 400 games. Keep going, buddy. On your way to 1,000. Little anniversary here at Missin Curfew. Anniversary, as Rick Rally would say.
You got an anniversary.
Of the best trade in Columbus Blue Jacks history. Oh, I believe shit. It went down yesterday. Scotty William Upshaw. William Scotty Upshaw got traded from the Phoenix Coyotes to the Columbus Blue Jackets for Rostislav Kleslav.
Don't bring it up. Don't bring it up. Dog. Talk about dog days.
You don't
days.
Have many bad days. How was
that was the dog days. How was that? That was the dog call. 3 months. Oh, man. The hotel was so shitty. I just didn't like the room at all. It was just brutal.
I love that Billy Quinn texts us looking for a hotel room in Columbus. He's like, up dog, I know it's not your favorite place, but so you text Commodore and Cobby's like, fuck, I haven't been there in forever, but this is the new hotel, I guess. Maybe we should go back. Hey, should we go back to Columbus and see if we can have a good weekend?
Or fuck no? Yeah.
Yeah, maybe we'll go give it a chance.
Yeah.
They're not going to make the playoffs, but.
Just do an honorary,
just to the trade.
I'm in. I'm in. I guess they got a new hotel there now. Thank God. Had I been in a better hotel, I might have liked it.
Did you eat at Nick and Sam's? No, what's the place there? Like the...
No, the Red, it's like a...
No, but what's their like chain restaurant they have there?
Fuck.
Not Nick and Sam's, I don't think. I ate there. Did you know that I went... My first NHL training camp was with the Columbus Blue Jackets. I went on an amateur tryout.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I opted out of the draft.
Yeah.
Thanks to the brilliant advice of Larry Kelly. Great advice, Larry. Tell me, opt out, you'll get drafted higher next year. Have a better year the next year. Don't get drafted. So now I'm looking for just a place to go to camp. And I went to Columbus.
Yep. I didn't know this.
Yeah, I went to Columbus on an amateur
tryout. And then where did... When did Anaheim step up?
Anaheim drafted me when I was 19 the next year.
Oh, so at 18, you still went to a camp?
At 18, I went to an amateur... It's what they called amateur tryout. And fuck was I an amateur.
So you actually opted out. So you weren't even eligible.
No, listen. So my first year, the central scouting comes out. I'm rated fourth round in North America.
Yeah.
So typically, I probably still would have got drafted where I did, seventh or eighth round, right? Yeah. If you pencil in the Europeans or who knows, right? And Larry Kelly gives us the advice. And we don't know, right? I don't know. My dad doesn't know. He's like, opt out. You'll go higher next year. Oh, great. Next year, I get like 30 points. Have a good year. Don't get drafted. Because what it does is if you get drafted 18, then you have that free agent year. So if you're drafted 18, you play 19, then you go back over age. If they don't sign you, you don't have to go back in the draft. You're just a free agent.
Yeah.
So not team's going to really do it unless you're a stud. So anyways, I went there on a tryout. So we both have a little bit of Columbus Blue Jack history.
Yeah, but mine's worse.
But at least you're
mine was nostalgic. Is that a good word?
Nostalgic, is that a word, boys? Can you look that up? Nostalgic?
Yeah.
It was disgusting.
But that's not the right word.
I don't know what it is. I felt sick. Is that what it is?
Well, you left Phoenix.
Nauseous?
Nauseous.
Yeah, that's the word.
Hey, you left Phoenix. Like, it's not like you were leaving.
That's when you get that, like, when you get that
when you
got to
break out the Pepto.
Yeah.
How I felt on the bird home from the...
Yeah, you're lucky you didn't shit your pants or puke on that one, eh? That's how I felt coming. If I would have had anything in my body coming back from Vegas, I would puke.
Really? See, I went no sleep right to Houston and then 3 hours right to Newport. Me and Liz, got off to that 75 and sunny and just was like, this is why I live here.
Me and Loops, that snapshot of it. Me and Loops, we were going to Boston to watch Pearl Jam. And we played golf here in LA. And we had the red eye. We had the early bird going out, right? Because we had to get there like 5 a.m. If we don't end up getting in one after golf. And we go right on this thing. Like, how they let us on the fucking thing, I'll still to this day never know. So, Updog, congratulations on that trade, buddy. I know it means a lot to you.
Thanks, bud. Thank you.
Our last segment of the day is brought to you by Good Life. We got our Good Life tarps on here.
We're wearing them.
Promo code Curfew. It's just called swag because that's what fucking Good Life is. It's swag. I was listening to the Freddie Anderson interview today. He had a Good Life Summit shirt on in Vegas, huh?
Freddie? He did, yeah, sweaty.
That's cool.
It was a little chilly there, that's why.
Yeah, it was. I just got to say to my old Vancouver Canucks, bring back the black and gold, baby.
That's right.
Those jerseys.
They now,
maybe
are
you can tinker,
thumping.
You can tinker the skate. If you don't want the skate.
I like that circle
skate.
I do too.
But I'm even saying just those colors.
Yeah.
Like
Dave Babbage.
Yeah, they look meaner than the blue and
Kirk
green.
Kirk McLean.
Yeah. Pavel.
Pavel. Alexander McGillney.
Gino Ojek.
Gino motherfucking Ojek.
Yurki Lumi.
Yurki Lumi.
Jeff Cortnell. Trevor Linden.
Linden. Yeah. Who else? Wolfie Samuelson?
No, I don't think so. Who else wore that color? Anyways, I think they're unbelievable. Do you like good the Canucks rundown. Jerseys?
I hate the ones they wear now.
I like the blue ones.
I got the white.
I never liked the white ones. Even when I played, I didn't like the white
I think
ones.
They let me keep my white, eh?
Oh, yeah. You went there for a tryout, too.
Yeah. I've kept the jersey. I got the Edmonton one, and I got the Vancouver one.
Yeah.
And I got a sick Vancouver bag. I like the bag.
Could you do the black and gold with the new symbol, with the orca whale with the sea? Would that look all right or no? I just like that black and gold. Black and yellow. Black
it
and
needs
yellow.
To stay as a go-to. Meaner. They need like seven games at least in that thing.
Yeah.
Like and then
Patterson
if they
look like he was a little bit.
Yeah. He looks bigger too.
Yeah.
Black's better than blue.
I agree.
I always wore blue growing up. Like Fort McMurray Oil Barons, blue. Nashville, blue. Philly, black. Then I went to black.
Philly's got great unis.
Great unis.
When you would wear the black ones. You guys were tough to beat in that. So that segment was brought to you by our good friends at Good Life, baby. Swag.
Swag City.
Vancouver Canucks, please get that black and gold. Keep them humming. I always, my 2 years there, all I asked that the leadership group or the, not even the leadership group, like TC Carl and these guys, I'm like, give us one night where we can wear the black and golds.
Humming
now they
and
wear
hawk.
Them. No, at least
they're
them.
Good. They're good now. Yeah. I mean, they got to do something. They're kind of in a race, but now things are going to get tough after the trade deadline. They have some games to play.
I'll tell you what. It's a great point by you. Last night, they go in to play Jersey. Yaroslav Halak, he's a great goaltender. But Thatcher Demko has been one of the hottest goalies in the league. And I love Bruce Boudreau. And they decided to go with Halak. And they got shellacked by the Devils. Which is just where they are in the
what was season. That score? 7?
7-2 they beat. Like, let's look here.
They have more games to play than anyone in the league.
They have 55 games played. And they are 4 points out in the Pacific. Your Vegas Golden Knights are kind of taking a little bit of a slide.
I know they are.
LA. Who's LA kidding? Edmonton. Come on, Edmonton. They had a couple little lapses there, up dog. This Pacific division is wide open. But yeah, it's something to be said on back-to-back games with Thatcher Demko. I don't know. I love Bruce Boudreau. I'm not chirping Bruce, but when you're in this race, like, I don't know. Something that's why we're not coaches, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. So, we're going to stick to podcasting.
We're going to stick to podcasting. Up dog, DraftKings lock of the week.
Boy, oh boy, is
you're
the up dog
you're at it,
hot.
You're at it again, buddy. You are 11.
I went with the
two.
Beantown on the road. Thank you very much.
They're playing great, man.
Aren't
I
they?
I watched them kick the shit out of the Kings last night, 7-0.
I know. Well, I took them on the road knowing that they were going to pumble smash the San Jose Sharks.
And speaking of the Kings, I took the Kings at home against the Islanders.
Saturday, the Oilers said the Oilers beat the Panthers on the road.
How about the game on the Maple Leafs Red Wings 10-7? Are you kidding me? 10-7?
That's like a first quarter game. You know,
man, I wish I would have had the first period over in that game.
Man, oh man.
Moving on to this week's lock of the week presented by our good friends at DraftKings. Up dog. I think I go first because you're winning. How do you feel about that?
I don't care. I'm gonna keep winning. I'm gonna get that bottle of Camus.
Was it Camus? Max, you got to go back
it?
On the archives.
I think it was a dinner at Nobu.
No, Nobu was for the first in the Pacific.
Okay.
Which we both might not win.
No, we're not winning.
And then that way, Max has got to take us. Just joking, Maxie.
Yeah, that was the rule.
Actually, up you go first. You're winning. You go.
Okay. I have a lock of the week, and it's going to be on Saturday night. And it is the... Oh, man, this is easy. This is just so fucking easy. I am expecting the Florida Panthers to just absolutely wax. I knew you were going to take that. Wax a million the Red Wings. The Panthers are getting beat up here bad. They lost four in a row. So a couple wins to get them back in the win column and then count them on pumping the Detroit Red Wings. Not like the Wings used to go in back in the day and kick our ass in Florida. This is different.
Payback.
Payback time.
I'm going to take the Boston Bruins on the road against your favorite city, the Columbus Blue Jackets.
There you go.
Bruins are playing unbelievable. They're back. And by the way, Jake DeBrusk.
Hattie.
Everyone, get rid of him. And I've been saying it all year. I'm going to pump my own tires here. I've been telling everyone all year this Jake DeBrusk kid is a player.
Yeah.
And now he's got, I think, 14 goals or 17 goals or something.
Fucking break.
He plays in straight lines. He goes to the net. He's big. Like, I watch a lot of hockey. I don't see guys like Jake DeBrusk out there. So,
you're right.
Obviously, Don Sweeney knew that, and that's why he didn't trade him. So, Jake, good on you. That was a lock of the week. Brought us into our top titty. DraftKings top titty. Congratulations to Tilly135.
Tilly, man. 135.
Tilzy.
He had Kadri and Troch. What Jordan Kyrou. Fox.
Hagel. Oh, yeah. And Makar. Petrangelo. Oh,
there you go. Ville Husso.
Yeah, this is Ville Husso. But Binnington's back 40, playing good, eh?
40% drafted of Ville Husso and 23 points. How are you? Wow.
Well,
it's really killing it.
Brent up, Brento, 68th place. Took Jack Eichel. Max Miller, 74th place. Max, hey, banger, man. Big what? Like second, and then what happened, bro? You got stoned and didn't watch it, or what? What happened here, bro?
I chose Binnington because I knew him, and he didn't even play. I don't think. And so I got a couple snowflakes on my team. Eichel didn't do too hot. Mikola didn't do hot.
You went with Kopitar. You went with Kopitar again.
I got to go with my Kings. I got to stay true to LA.
Trevor Moore. You know what? Trevor Moore is a nice player for the LA Kings. And you know what? He's probably not expensive in this. So Trevor Moore, you watch this guy buzz. He plays a lot like you.
Does he?
Kind of out of control.
Does he mix it up after?
not like you.
No.
Not like you. So this week, the games are right here. Ready? We got a big Friday night for the top titty. Me and Uppy, we didn't get in the top two this week, but we're not going to find ourselves because we were working.
And I was freezing. I was actually cold as shit.
And to Max, Max gave us the countdown, right? Like what?
I gave you guys about 45 seconds to get your lineup in when I realized it was Friday night at 3:59 p.m. or whatever
time it was. I was so cold I was getting a coffee or something, right? Remember?
Yeah, we're sitting in that warming hut basically in the locker room warming up.
I was sitting on that warming hut on these flimsy fold-out chairs being like, is this the chair they're going to give me here?
Same is this what covering the National Hockey League is going
to
be like?
Hey, that was the media room, guys. Welcome to the media.
No, at the autograph session, I love the Nashville Predators, but you know, some of your alumni have put a few on since you retired. That chair at the autograph session for an hour or two.
I was going down.
Oh, I wasn't even put my full weight on it. I was like sitting on my feet more than anything. I was just kind of like, oof. I could have went through that bad boy. That just one of those and it would have went right through it. How about the fans that showed up for that, by the way?
Yeah, it was awesome.
It was cool.
We didn't get to talk about it enough about the fans, but a lot of people.
The Nashville fans, I told you this too, Uppy, they're so polite, right? Thank you, the Southern hospitality. Anyways, DraftKings top titty. Minnesota at Buff, Wings Lightning, Devils Rangers, Penguins Hurricanes, Canucks versus Uppy's Blue Jackets, Stars Jets, Golden Knights versus the Anaheim Ducks. So we got a nice top titty. I'm going to have to really dig in. We'll be playing Friday golf. I'll remind you. Billy Quinn's coming in this week to play some Friday golf with the boys. That was top titty. Up dog. Love you, buddy. The fellow tour continues. We got one more stop. We will be back in Nashville for the DraftKings NHL Fantasy
World Championship.
World Championship?
World Championship, baby.
Whoa.
Yeah, and whoa. Then after that, we take a little bit of a break on the old liver.
Just a little, a lot of walking on the fellas tour. A lot of walking, Bangard. A lot of walking on the fellas tour. A lot of walking. If there's any companies out there, Apple Watch or whatever, I'd like to get our steps over the fellas tour.
I think we got them.
There'd be a lot of steps. We did a lot of walking. No?
Yeah,
you're the world's fastest walker.
Thanks, bud. Appreciate that.
Fucking you get her going. Anyways, Maxi Binger, thank you, Updog. Always love being in the studio with you. We got a great guest coming up next.
Yes, sir.
The man, the myth, the legend, the man of the week last week in Nashville, Pekka Rinne. DraftKings, baby. The basketball and hockey seasons have reached their second halves. And what better way to get in on all the action but with DraftKings, the leader in one-day fantasy sports. Claim your free shot at millions of dollars in total prizes when using code CURFEWKINGS during signup. Playing daily fantasy hockey is simple. Just pick your lineup, stay under the salary cap, and see how your team stacks up against the competition. Basketball fans, you can feel the sweat like never before. Every dunk, steal, assist means so much more with DraftKings daily fantasy lineup. With DraftKings, payday comes every day for players. So what are you waiting for? Head to the app now. Download the DraftKings app now and use the code CURFEWKINGS during signup. This week, DraftKings is putting you in the action with a free shot at millions of dollars in total prizes. That's code CURFEWKINGS, and you can get a free shot at millions of dollars in total prizes only at DraftKings. Minimum $5 deposit required. Eligibility restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com for details. Welcome back to Missin' Curfew. Up dog, we got the man of the weekend.
Yeah,
the man of fucking every time, pretty much, though. But the man of the weekend for sure.
He's gonna run this town tonight.
Yeah, that was a great post.
I know. Up. Well, what an incredible weekend, and we're just very happy to welcome our boy
Pekka Rinne.
Thanks, boys. Happy to be here.
How you feeling, buddy? Have you recovered from your from the festivities?
Holy shit! It's been overwhelming, man. It's what a week. Unbelievable. I mean, it was emotional. It was everything I could have think of. And, but yeah, still a little tired, recovery mode, ready to head home.
Yeah. Hey, you and us both, Pex.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Sure. Pex, I want to get to the ceremony with you, buddy, but I want to get back to like when you first came over here to the American League, cause you touched on your first game and your speech and stuff like that. But coming from Finland and you got to the American League, what were your thoughts? Did you like it? Were you like, maybe I should go back to Finland? Or did you just embrace the long road trips and being with the boys and it built some character for you?
No, I loved it. I was really nervous. I remember that. Obviously, coming from Europe, language is a huge thing. So, like, you know, early first couple of years, you know, struggling with that. I understood everything, but you know, the conversation part, that was the toughest. But no, I loved it. And I think Uppy obviously remembers that my first couple of years, I, you know, right away I met you, and there were so many other guys I, you know, pretty much grew up and stayed friends over the years. But, it was awesome. I loved it. I don't know. It was,
smiling.
I was going to say
smiling and laughing and stopping pucks is a good way to just learn the English language for Pex, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I think I had the right attitude, you know, like when I came over, I wasn't really worried about anything. I wasn't stressing about anything, and it was awesome.
No, and that goes to just the type of guy you are, because there's some guys I've played with that come over from Europe or Finland or Sweden or Germany, where there's good leagues, good pro leagues, and they come to the American League and they're kind of like, fuck, this is brutal. Like, you know, it's better at home kind of thing.
Yeah, and a lot of times back home, guys are already making pretty good money. And you know, when they come over and they play in AHL, and, you know, the salary is not as good and things like that. So I think that affects a lot of guys.
Pex, talk about the road through Milwaukee and what that vision was like for, you know, for us back in the day with David Poile and Trotsky, and just like, you know, the guys that we put through that system, that the Ham Hughes, you know, Suter, myself, Webbs, Toots, yourself. Just talk about the importance of, you know, learning the game through, you know, like, riding the bus, the appreciation of what it's like to actually get up to the NHL when you're there. Our coaches, Claude.
Eating cold pizza on the bus.
You know, tin foil boxes. Yeah.
And packed.
Chew spitters everywhere.
And just, you can go into like what it was like even going into the playoffs and just like, you know, struggles. It's not like perfect NHL playoff systems when we go into the NHL playoffs in the AHL, and Obi would know too, but just talk about the road to Milwaukee and maybe what that did to your, you know, the beginning of your career and how you grew as a young guy.
I think it was so important. You know, coming over, didn't have a lot of expectations. I was obviously 8th round pick. I knew I needed to grind, and So I was happy to be honest, I was happy to go to AHL just to learn, you know, learn the game, learn to, you know, the off ice stuff, get comfortable. And I was, you know, I loved my time in Milwaukee, and especially that 2005-06 season. And I got to play my first NHL game that year and, you know, won that game. Everything went well. So I, you know, I thought that, you know, I got this. I, you know, it's not that hard, eh? Like, yeah.
Pax, I do.
Yeah, and then I had to wait for my next game for like two more years. So it was so good for me, like mentally and everything, because there were times I remember after 2 years in Milwaukee, I thought that, you know, this is my chance. I'm gonna get it, you know, I'm gonna make the team. And after the training camp, they sent me down for the third time, and I was rattled. I was pissed. And but ended up having a really good year, and I think that's just prepared me for you know, I was ready when I got up, and right away I started playing a lot of games when I got to NHL.
Yeah, there was no question you had fire in you to not let, you know, to not let anyone kind of get in the way of your dreams and your goals of being, you know, being a Hall of Fame goaltender that you are. I do want to bring up your first NHL game and your first win, because to me, it was after my rookie party.
Your style, your goaltending style got a lot better as your career went on, too. I saw the video of your first game. Your style, wow, it got a lot better, Pex.
Thanks, Ol.
Pex,
I was like a soccer goalie.
Just big-ass feet, long legs, goofy
diving,
helmet.
Diving across the crease.
Two gloves on, catching everything, just doing your thing.
Oh, yeah.
Well, what do you remember your first NHL game? Because I'll tell you what I remember of the game before that. It was in Florida, and we had just had our rookie dinner. And, you know, we all obviously had fun, and I think it was – Pex, were you on the trip? Was it your rookie? Did you get the rookie? Okay, so you got called up right after this. But it was me and, you know, Toots, and then they, like, Simone Gamache, and they had a bunch of guys that we had our rookie dinner for. In Florida.
Simone Gamache
was up there.
I still want to kill that little fucker. <out there>.
So we go in to play Florida, and Thomas Vogoden was hurt at the time. Chris Mason was starting, and Brian Finley, who was our first round pick back in 2000 and maybe, let's say, 2000, probably.
Yeah,
he was our backup. Well, Mason, after warmups, comes off, and he's like, I just tweaked my groin. Like, I'm done. So they're like, Finley, you're going in. And Finley had been on a 2-day bender since the rookie dinner. And when he got in there, you can see it on his face. He was like, uh-oh, you know, this is not going to be good. Like, I'm not prepared at all.
And get in the shooting lanes, boys.
And boy, did he get caught in the Nathan Horton sweepstakes, because Nathan Horton got four on him in the first, I want to say it was the first period and a half. And Jamie Allison, our defenseman, who was our 7th D, pretty much had the backup goalie gear on Obes, and the TV camera crew had Allison's face on the Jumbotron, and the whole crowd in Florida was chanting, like, put him in, because we were down like 7-0. And sure enough, like, we just Finley stayed in. We lost, I think, 8-1. And then the next game, Pex got called up. And that was when, you know, you get the reins and you run with it. But yeah, we had a good squad back then, Pex. That was
I remember that. I was watching the game you mentioned when Finner played. I was watching that game in Milwaukee with the boys and just chucking beers and boys were like, get ready, Pex. I think you're gonna get called up.
They're like, Pex, maybe have one beer, one water from now on. I think you're going up there.
Pex, sure enough, night I get called up, and it was awesome.
I want to ask you about being an eighth rounder, because first of all, I don't know how the fuck you... I was an eighth rounder, too. I went 250th overall. What were you?
258.
Oh, wow. It's got you. Yeah.
Did you use that as motivation throughout your career, or did you just... I kind of looked at it as it was an opportunity no matter what round you went in. Did you use it as motivation, or you didn't care what round you got drafted in?
At that point, to be honest, I didn't really care.
Yeah.
When you go past... I don't know, three rounds, whatever. It doesn't really matter, right? Like, so I don't know. That was kind of like you mentioned, like a kind of chance for me, opportunity. I that's how I saw it. And obviously at first I was just happy I got drafted, because at the time I was already 20 years old. So I was, I was 2 years past my you know, when guys usually get drafted. So I was just happy that I, you know, I got noticed, and then I knew I might have a chance down the road, and yeah, it was huge for me.
Yeah, that's just the reason I asked, because that's how I kind of embraced it too. Like you hear about like Tom Brady, how he was drafted fourth round. I was never really pissed off about it. I was just like, yeah, I was an eighth round pick. You know, I shouldn't play one game. Now I've played 3 years in the league, 4 years in the league. I just use it as A, it was an opportunity, and B, you almost have nothing to lose, right, Pex?
Yeah, that's right. And growing up, like I mentioned in my speeds, I wasn't like a superstar young player, you know, growing up. I didn't play World Juniors. I didn't play any national team games. I before I came over, I just made my hometown pro team. I was a backup goalie over there. Niklas Backstrom actually was the starting goalie. Ended up having a good career in Minnesota, but we had a really good team, so I think it was really, you know, so I was pretty humble guy at that point. You know, I had to really work hard to, you know, make a name for myself. So I think it was a good setting for myself to succeed, you know, like
it made you enjoy it more.
Yeah, and humble is a good word for you, Pex. Yeah.
I just loved every day at the rink with sometimes. You always had a smile. Because we had a good year the year I played with, but you made practice fun. You know, there's some goalies I played with that didn't make practice fun at times, right?
Yeah, I tell you what, my first ever training camp, and then I played my first 9 games in Nashville. I hit Dunham. Dunham was our goalie, right? What's his first name?
Mike
Dunham.
I hit him
in practice. Like, you know, you fuck around from the corner and you try to sauce one in there. I hit him in the back of the leg with a puck one day. Like, it was as soft as anything, right? But I'm a rookie. I'm only 19. He turned and launched his stick at me in the corner, like almost took off a couple guys' heads. And I'm like, holy shit. You know, and I'm like, Pex would just turn and laugh at you. He'd be like, he'd turn and laugh and be like, you know, you miss me. Hit me again, you know? Yeah. But yeah, so that's something I always enjoyed about you, Pex, is you always had fun, although you were the hardest working guy, and, you know, losing ate you up, right? So, you know, that fire
you
within.
You didn't lose a whole lot.
No,
so
I know.
That was good.
I know.
That was good. But Pex, I want to talk to you. I want to ask you about.
I have nothing but the best memories. Like, I mean, even this last week, like, you know, you go back down the road and you reflect back, and I mean, you just think about all your teammates. It was like you guys, you know, it was so awesome to see in Nashville, and you know, all the good times. They would, like, there's so many stories and stuff.
It was unbelievable. Pex, I want to ask you about the city. We were talking about it, and you know, from the time I was there with you, and Uppy was there before you in a little bit, but how much it's grown. And just, like, did you ever think you'd see 70,000 people at a Nashville Predators hockey game? Granted, there were some Tampa fans, but just how much the city grew throughout your time?
Yeah, I never could have believed that. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, the day we all first came to Nashville, it's such a different city now. You know, there's every single huge luxury hotel chains. It's the place to be nowadays. It's awesome. I mean, I'm so happy for the boys and happy for this fan base. I mean, they deserve that. It's great.
Yeah,
the change is just unreal.
You can almost get lost in Nashville now. When I played there, no matter how drunk you got, you can find your way home. Right? You see the Batman building, which
I
did.
Find Broadway. You either go up and up or down.
You're like, I'll find my place.
If you ever lose your buddy, just go back to the tin roof, and you'll find him behind the bar or in the freezer.
Exactly.
Pex, and that brings me right up to the fans, man. Like, I was blown away. You know, coming from Vancouver to Nashville, how passionate they were and stuff like that, but how much they loved you. You know, it's got to be a great feeling for you to how much the fan, like, that's what I took away from, how much the players loved you, but how much the fans truly loved you, fella.
Yeah, I mean, I feel so fortunate. I think part of it is obviously, you know, me being there for so long. So, you know, you create that connection and that bond. And, you know, I felt that love pretty early on. I mean, you know, 08, 09, and just started growing and growing. And, you know, I embraced that relationship. It's been awesome. But I do that it plays a huge role, obviously, that I've played a long time here and you know, being able to kind of have that connection.
Pex, I don't know if you were able to see the highlight reel. I mean, you saw him firsthand because you were the one making all the saves back in the day.
Yeah, wow.
But during your ceremony, the highlight reel that Nashville and the NHL put together for you was something special, including a goal where you had yeah. Yossi jump in your hands after. But just, I mean, I think we only saw one clip.
No, Pax, I forgot about this, but they were showing your unbelievable saves. Fuck, you had a bunch of them. But it was game two in Vancouver. We're 1-1 in overtime, right? I think it was double overtime or something. And me and Blummer are on the ice, and I'm on the left side, kind of doing a piss poor job of trying to get in the lane. But Blummer, I don't know what the fuck Blummer was doing. He comes all the way over to my side, sauces it through both of us, and you came across and made that backdoor save. I was in the suite.
Yeah, on Bieksa.
On Bieksa,
right?
Yeah. Not a better guy to make it on, by the way. Not a better guy to make it on. And I look at Uppy in the suite. I'm like, fuck, I forgot about that save. So what a save, fella. We won that game and tied it up 1-1. Eh? Attaboy.
Thanks, brother. I remember that.
Yeah, but Pax, I mean, the crowd just watching that, you could see just people like in awe, man, of just, you know, how athletic you were, how you used to use your stick. Your stick was almost part an extension of your third leg, let's say. But, you know, and then talk about the art of you catching the puck everywhere you used to catch it. I remember Mitch Korn, our goalie coach in Nashville, being like, you know, Jesus, I don't teach him this. He does it, and it's working. So I'm not going to change it. But I always remember.
I guess you're not Mitch. Yeah. I guess you're not Mitch.
But Mitch Korn, you know, and you can speak about Mitch too a little bit, Pex. He was, you know, a Thomas Vokoun. You know, he made Voki into the goalie he was, and Voki was great. And then Chris Mason had a great career. So maybe talk about that, but just that unorthodox play of catching it, you know, on your left shoulder, basically on your right shoulder, you could catch it with your left hand. It's pretty wild.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I grew up, I always had a baseball mitt in my hand growing up. I always like threw the ball against like any wall and I would catch it. And I played baseball you know, that was my thing. I always carried a mitt and a ball with me and just threw the ball and cast it. And then even like street hockey, I would just have like a stick and a glove and no blocker. So I would like, from early on, I would like start catching balls and pucks from like across the body. And I think it just stuck with me I always tried to prevent rebounds and sometimes that got me into trouble too. You know, I shoot it so hard and I try to catch it from across the body. But I still think that it was my strength, and I'm just happy that, you know, first of all, like Mitch didn't try to get that out of me. He kind of embraced it and wanted me to, he saw that it's working you know, he tried Brian Finley to start doing that.
He needed to do something.
He needed to catch with the other hand, I think. Hey, Finn's had to catch with the other hand.
Yeah. But I mean, I think that was one thing. And obviously Mitz was crucial, my early years. He was awesome. I mean, back in the day, he coached Hasek and told me a bunch of stories and it was awesome. Mitch. He's a special guy.
I like Mitch. I just remember my first months in Nashville playing in front of you. I was like, fuck, this guy doesn't give up any rebounds. This is unbelievable. This is great. I could just literally turn and start cross-checking, guys, because I know Pex is going to catch it. So it was nice.
Pex, you had a lot of guys show up to your ceremony, man. I want to ask you about how special it was to have your family there, your little guy, you know, and just how cool it is being a father and what that means to you right now in your life.
Oh man, everything. It's, I mean, past week having my family here, having you boys there, bunch of my ex-teammates, my buddies from Finland, they had a
couple
had
beauties
a,
there, boy.
They had a week.
Yeah, they're
they
great.
Had a week. Oh boy. But yeah, it was so unreal. I mean, just, you know, this past Sunday when I took my parents to the airport, they went back to Finland and I mean, they were speechless. They were in tears. Like, I mean, I'm sure they were proud. You know, they they were proud of their son, but at the same time, everything that happened over that week. And for me, it was special that I got to share that with everybody. And just so thankful that, you know, a bunch of my ex-teammates came over. And but yeah, I'm just happy with my current life.
Yeah.
Dad life's
a good life.
Paulus, I know, it's unreal. He's 15 months now, and he's doing
great.
He's
a little stud, yeah. Yeah, he's a stud. Oh yeah.
He was so good on the ice. I was worried he was gonna have a meltdown or something, but he was so good.
Yeah, he knew. He's like, he saw you all dressed up. He's like, I got to keep it quiet here for Dad right now. Keep it classy. Pex, I want to ask you about a guy that means a lot to me, and I only had him for 1 year, and Uppy too, is Walks, Brandon Walker. You know, just seeing him again. I know how much that night meant to him because of what he thinks about you, but just your relationship with him and how good he is for players in Nashville.
Oh, man. It's outside from your teammates. I think Brandon is like the closest guy, you know, off the ice, and everything he does for the boys, for the team, it's unbelievable. I mean, you know, obviously without him, I don't think that organization is in the same place. I mean, he makes shit happen, he's an awesome guy, he
pays attention to the details for the boys.
Yeah, and he's definitely he's helped grow the game.
He knows what's up.
He's helped grow the game, hasn't he?
Oh, big time.
Yeah, we love Walks, man. I remember him when I first got there. He was the guy always to ask you what you need. You know, you got plans for lunch, like, if not, let's grab lunch. So he was great for young guys. I want to ask you about a guy who stood on stage with you and who means a lot to you as a leader and as a teammate and as a good friend right now is Shea Weber, and just the welcoming he got from that Nashville crowd, you know, when he stepped on the ice to help you out there. Webbs is a true warrior, a champion. Like, he's, you know, he just bleeds, you know, team and friend first. So just what's a guy like Shea Weber mean to you, and how nice was it to have him there on stage with you?
Oh, it was special. I mean, we both started 05, and that first year in Milwaukee, I mean, he didn't have to play a lot of minor games. I mean, it was too good. It was too good. But
once he blew one puck through the net in practice, yeah. You're like, okay, I think we could use this on the power play.
Exactly. But even though he's younger than me, he's born 85. I'm born 82, and I still looked up to him. It was, you know, right away you meet him and you see his character, and he's like you mentioned, he's a leader, and he's a kind of team first guy, and that never makes a number about himself. He's you know, he's all about the boys. He's you guys know how he is. But it was special. I mean, we became right away. We clicked and became good friends, and having him here that night on the stage, it meant a lot to me. And but yeah, what a guy.
It was great. The applause he got when he came out too from the fans. I was like, wow, unreal. That's unreal. But I just remember, like, when I first got to Nashville, and you actually told a story in the third period when he came up after your jersey night, how hard he would shoot the puck at you. Right, and you're telling the story about PK Subban came over and started shooting muffins at you. You're like, PK, you can lean on it a bit. They're like, I just had Shea Weber, but I remember, like, before I was really comfortable on the team, I'm like, you know, I just played in front of Luongo, where if you shot high on Lou, like, you were getting the stank eye from everyone. Where you kind of you embraced it. You're like, shoot it harder, Webb. Shoot it harder. Like, that's kind of how it was in Nashville.
Yeah, and you know, that guy, he's so competitive. So I think I learned part of those things from him, and it was always competition on the ice. It didn't matter if it's a warm up for the goalies. You know, guys shoot muffins from the blue line, and he would always walk in and just tee it off. And I'm like, what are you doing, man? But he, you know, if he would snipe, he would let me hear about it. So I always wanted to, you know, I always wanted to stop him, and it was always game on, you know, when we were on the ice. And at the end of the practice, when the D is doing one-timers, it was always like we were counting on,
yeah,
you know. And I you know, I'm a terrible chirp. Like, I don't have any chirps. So, like, you know, when
you just laugh.
When Yeah, when I just laughed, it made him so angry. And like, you know, oh, cats a puck. And I'm like, just laughing. I'm like, oh, that's easy. And it was just making him, and he would shoot so hard.
Oh, we used to work on penalty. So we used to work on penalty kill power play. It felt like every day, right? And I mean, Pax is the best. I'm like, Pax, I'm not getting in the lane. And you're like, I know you're not. Holmes. I'm like, I won't let it go back door though, Pax, but I'm not blocking Ramsey's shot.
Pex, do you recall, just on the topic, but do you recall a shooter in the league that you felt was the best shooter ever that you faced? Like one guy in particular, maybe throughout your career?
I mean, Ovi.
Yeah.
I actually have a story about Ovi. It wasn't until like 2 years ago, he sniped his first goal against me, and we talked after the game, and he's like, dude, like I haven't scored on you. I've been lucky though. But yeah, so in that game, he sniped two on me. But but I think he's a one guy. I mean, he shoots from any position. His shots are so weird. Like, I mean, his blade is like it's like a wedge.
Yeah, it's an up shoot.
And but he shoots it hard, and it's always curving. It's no fluke that he has almost 800 goals. But, I mean, he's one, and then obviously, I mean, there's so many great scorers in the game, but I think there's a one guy. I mean, there's guys who I've played a lot against, like Patrick Kane. We played Chicago all the time, and I mean, as a shooter, but you know, he's such a creative player, makes room for his teammates and makes plays. And, you know, I think he was a one guy that you had to be ready at all times.
So when I got traded from Anaheim to Tampa my rookie year. So I'm in the same division as Ovi, and I'm just trying to get in this league somehow. And everything on the power play is going through him, Pex, and he'll shoot any puck. Like if it's rolling, it doesn't matter. And I remember like one's just like, whoo, whizzing by my head, no visor.
Yeah,
I'm like,
you don't care. Yeah.
I'm like, hey, fuckhead, like keep him down a bit here. Like, but yeah, he would shoot it anywhere, and like he'd always hit the net, Pex, and it seemed like it was always like kind of dipping and diving.
I know.
Yeah,
and it's always like rolling and
Pex. We the other night during the shootout, it was great because you and I we got to watch the shootout together, and you were calling guys' shots. You called Sagan low blocker. You called a couple guys, and
what a pro!
And this is funny because because when we all signed your guitar, we had to write something on there for you, and I wrote a close that five hole, Pex, eh? And then I said congrats, but I used to just skate by some of my old teammates, especially the goalies. And I'd kind of like say, I'm getting one on you tonight or whatever. And I never really did. I wasn't much of a goal scorer.
But I never really did.
But
don't be mine.
But listen, so I had a play. I have a move. And my goalies would tell you this down the stretch in St. Louis. Like, you know, Alan would know. But I come in on a two-on-one on my offside. And I kind of look at the D and pretend I'm going to pass. And I rip one five-hole. And it was just my thing. So I was thinking, fuck.
I think you got me one time.
The goal on you that I ended up getting one on you, and it was just that same play. But had you have known that this was my little practice move, you would have just like easily just bing. So I remember getting that one in three or five hole, and I was always like, fuck, I'm just, you know, one goalie that I would just be so happy leaving the game scoring on is my fucking buddy Pekka Rinne. So I got to tell you.
I remember that.
Yeah.
I think
I was so pissed.
I mean, I know you would be for sure. It was at home too, eh? It was at home, and I remember I scored, and I'm like, fuck, I black out every time I score. I jump into the glass, just all the fans are like, look at this fucking guy here, right? He still thinks he's 22. He's going to the tin roof after.
I wonder how many I wonder how many career shots you had on Pex. So you were one for what?
Probably
30? You played in St. Louis in the same division as him. So you played
Totally. I actually didn't get to play the
Arizona.
I didn't get to play.
We gotta look that up. We'll
the
find
Nashville
out.
Predators for so long after I got traded. And one of the first games that I did get to play was in Phoenix, but Ellis was the goalie. And I happened to get a fucking natural hat trick, and all I wanted to do was fucking see Poile after the game. I was like, I cannot wait to see David Poile after this game and just give him like a little handshake and say, how are you, Dave? Got the natural.
Still bitter, got traded. Eh?
Oh,
still
bitter, for sure.
Hey, Pax, what? We were late to the festivities the other night at the stadium series. Up, dog. We had to get something to eat before the game. But what happened with the catfish there? Got stuck on the finger, or what happened there?
Did you guys see that?
I saw the I saw the highlights not until the next day, to be honest with you. I was a little pinned at the – but what happened? Just got caught on the finger or what?
Yeah, so Teo Luan, the football player, he's like, Pex, I want to give the catfish to you. And, you know, the fans are going to go crazy. Like, they don't care about me. And so I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll drop the puck. I'll crop the face from you and I'll pump the crowd. And the last minute, he's like, hey, like, don't throw it hard. Like, the head might fall off. Like, it's like the face was like cut open. Like, it was disgusting. It was like rotten. Like, so like I cropped the fist and I wanted to like do like a bowling move, just like slide it across the ice, and sure enough get stuck in my fingers and it's like whoop, and almost hits this lady in the head. Yeah, it was like so close.
Your reaction was unbelievable. It like leaves your head, you're like,
I know, I'm like, holy shit. Hey, it was funny.
One night in Smashville, right after the anthem, I still had my bucket off. And I was doing the sniffer and the fucking, and if that fucking thing doesn't hit me in the head and fall right down the bench, my hair stunk like dirty old fish. Oh, the bench stunk like
gross.
I was like, is that my fingers or did someone throw fish on the bench?
Get it, Ben.
Pex, I want to ask you from a personal perspective, our year together. I talked to Sully about this, JP Webb, as an organization, we got over the hump for the first time and beat the Ducks. And I just remember Poyle coming in and Fenton. I think I talked to you about it too, actually. And Fenton coming in and people were crying. And I was like, holy shit. Like, we still got to play here, boys. But it was a huge momentum and a step in the right direction for the whole organization.
Yeah, I think it was huge for the organization. It's you could tell how big that was. Like, you know, you remember those reactions. Like, us boys, we were kind of like, you know, what's happening here? Like, we gotta move on to the second round. But it was massive, and I think after that, it did something to the team management and everybody. The expectations, they grew, and I think before our Stanley Cup was kind of like, you know, I don't want to be rude, but to make the playoffs, and that, you know, everybody was happy.
Yeah,
we were always underdogs, and you know, no pressure whatsoever. And I think it was so good for us that, you know, that year we beat the Ducks. Next few years, a lot of good things happened. And the expectations, they grow, and you expect it to win. And as a player, you love that feeling. You want that pressure. And we needed that.
How about our boy, real quick, how about our boy Joel Ward before game six there?
That's one of the greatest hockey stories.
Anyone seen Wardle? No, Pekka Rinne, Wardle, no Webbs. I'm like, fuck's Wardle. Texted him, calling him, nothing.
Slept
right through the fucking.
Did you have an afternoon game?
No, afternoon game. Yeah. It was 7 o'clock start, and we're like,
He missed the game.
He missed
the playoff game.
No, he played in the game, didn't he?
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he came in. He missed the meetings. He missed every meeting.
Oh,
And then he came in. He's just like walking with his gitch bag. He's like, my man. I'm like, what happened? He's like,
my man.
He's like, I'm like, could happen to anyone. But he played, and we won that game. Yeah.
Brandon Walker, guy we just talked about. He has a great story about this. He was the guy who went to pick Wardle up from his from his apartment, and couldn't get, like, he was like hammering the door. Like, just trying to get him up, and he's like banging the windows. And
I go, Wardo, don't worry, it could happen to anybody. It could happen to anyone, fella. Get ready here for the game. But hey, real quick, touch on how good of a teammate Wardo was. Like, I was only there with him for a year, but man, what a great teammate, huh, Pex?
Unreal. One of the best guys. I mean, I heard he's a coach now.
I know.
So happy for him. Lucky guys to have him. I can only imagine how he is as a coach. He's one of those guys. He's a team first guy. So laid back. It's unreal. Like, I mean, everybody loved Wardo. Wherever he goes, he's loved. One of the best teammates.
He's the man.
Pex, is there anything you could share on your run to the cup when you guys walked through us in the second round? It was truly a magical, you know, a magical run for you guys. The city of Nashville, you know, what that excitement was. Obi went to the finals there. You know, your takeaway from you know, a cup run like that and just how close you were. Is there anything that stands out to you there?
I think the the first round against Chicago, I think something happened to us, and we barely made the playoffs that year. We were like 8th seed in the West or 7th seed. Played Chicago in the first round, 4-0 sweep, and that was like a huge confidence booster. Before that, I mean, Chicago was always kind of like, you know, it was like an older brother and that you couldn't beat.
He was picking on you all the time. Yeah.
Oh, exactly. And then moved on, and every round we just gained momentum and confidence, and it was unreal. And then, you know, our city and the fans, they started getting recognition, and it turned into like this magical place. And it's still my favorite hockey memory, that whole run. And it's bittersweet too, because by that point, I already had played a long time. So I knew that it's really hard to get deep in the playoffs. And, you know, you get to the Stanley Cup playoffs and you realize that this could be it. Like, this could be my chance. And, you know, play against Pittsburgh, and we end up coming short in six games. And so at that point, you're just crushed and you're disappointed. Yeah. But you get over it in a few months, and it turns into a great memory. But yeah. It is, for sure, it's still a little bit bittersweet.
I went in for game 3 and 4 with my buddy Mackel. And you remember your old teammate, Pierre Pronto?
Yeah.
So, PA, we come out. We're there for warm up, because we want to. The building's already full for warm up, right? So me and Mackel are down in the Lexus Lounge. I'm like, so PA's playing. He wasn't supposed to play. He's playing. I'm like, we got to go watch PA have warm up here. This flying Frenchman's going to be so excited. He comes out with his hair slicked back. He sees me and Mackel in the corner, and he thinks that like it's game on. He comes in. He's warming you up. Like, boom, one under the bar. Another one posted it. Like, everyone else is hitting your pads, and he's coming in. I'm like, you guys won the game, but I'm like, hey, good job warming pecs up there. He's like, oh, that was my time to shine, Holmes. That was my time to shine.
I know, and I was on fire in those playoffs. And then first two games in the finals in Pittsburgh, I was kind of shit. Like, I mean, I didn't play well. And then those games 3 and 4 at home, I played well. But I remember in those warm-ups, I'm like, I want to feel good. Like, I need to bounce back, and I need to play well. And yeah, PA is a sniping thing.
Everyone else is kind of just like warming you up, and he saw us. I'm like, that's a typical PA move. But you played great. That building Pex was, I mean, that thing was shaking. It was incredible.
Yeah, it was unreal.
Well, Pex, listen, man, we really appreciate you coming on. I just want to highlight this year for goaltenders, man. You and Henrik Lundqvist getting your jerseys retired is a really special moment for the NHL and for this generation of goalies. You know, a Swede and a great Finn. You know, to be recognized like that on that
two
level.
Two good looking cats. Hey, look at that smile.
With a nice little bank account to go with today. And hey, listen, we really appreciate it. You're a great teammate and a great friend to us, which is why we would drop our hat and come hang out with you at any time. But we really appreciate you coming on Missing Curfew and sharing your story, and we wish you all the best, pal.
Thanks, boys. Thanks for having me. And I want to say thanks to you guys. It's always been a pleasure, and awesome teammates. Love you guys.
Love you, Pex. Thank you,
love
buddy.
Love you, Pex.
Lip
peach
boomer.
Peach motherfucking dizzles.
I got a tangy citrus flavor right now going, sitting nice. It's been sitting in here, I'm not going to lie. How long have we been doing this? Hour and 15, 20 minutes?
Wow, that is a nice effort.
It's just sitting in there marinating.
I am
marinating lip boomer.
I am sitting across from you, my friend, and I am just logging on to my account right now because I got the new peach cobbler, clean peach, new in the case collection line. So shop now, CannaDipsCBD.com, independently tested dehydratic, American hemp CBD. That's what I'm talking about. Limited run, so stock up while the peaches are ripe. Obi, I know you're a California guy. You're a California roll guy. We're just talking about sushi here. Our boy Binger over there just fucking doesn't like sushi. So maybe he likes the California roll from Canadips.
Oh, I love a good California roll. 5 times 5 is 25. Up dog, what's that song? Peaches or cream? Remember that back in the day? The peaches.
Millions song? Of so peaches.
Peaches for me.
Yeah. It's presidency of the United States of America.
I used to pump that in my room.
Bumper trumper.
I love the California roll, up dog. I go 5x5, promo code Curfew Cali, get a nice little discount. They send it to you. I got to be honest, I have not tried the peach yet. I will order some right now because I got to try it.
Not only that, get the other, the case collection. There is another one, and it is called the golf one. It is the Palmy CBD, a true flavor innovation that is poised to take the world and your butthole by storm. In collaboration with golf heavyweights, Pins and Aces is the Palmy. The Palmy is a perfect blend of cracked black tea and natural citrus flavor herbs. Everyone can enjoy Arnie the classic taste wherever they go. The golf course or the office will never be the same again. Limited run again, so stock up while the Palmies are poured at your friends at Canadips.
Promo code Curfew Cali. Up dog. Pekka Rinne.
Fella.
What a guy.
What a guy. He's one of the best.
I could have kept talking to that beauty.
Yeah, 100%. I just love the, he hasn't changed the way he smiles, the way he laughs, the way he, you know, he talks about his teammates, you know, and that was just all brought back to us in you know, full life at this ceremony that he just had.
I love that he said about, you know, the American, that's kind of what I wanted to ask him because he was just like, I never knew he was an 8th round pick till last weekend. I was like, what?
You were drafted ahead of him.
Yeah, right? Different years. Yeah. Maybe, I don't know. I wonder if it was the same year. No, different years. But the character that he learned from to grinding and getting the American League, and that's what I think helped him turn into the guy he was, because even when I played with him, he was one of the best goalies in the league, arguably our best player besides him and Webbs, and he was just one of the best guys, right?
Yeah, it's wild to see someone come over, can't speak English, 6'6", goofy as fuck, and then turn into a guy that took a city to the Stanley Cup Finals, and describing you guys talking about when you won your first playoff round, what that meant to the city of Nashville, and then to the point where, you know, you have a goalie like Pekka Rinne and you're no longer ever considered an underdog. There's no chance if you have that guy in net that you're going to be an underdog.
Yeah.
Every year you have a chance to win. And that is single-handedly something that, you know, he carried.
It was a great question about that you asked him about his glove hand, because I've always often wondered, because when I lived in Finland, you wouldn't think kids play baseball there.
No.
Like, it's hockey and then soccer, I thought, or who knows.
So he just carried around an old Rawlings catcher's mitt.
He just carried away an old catcher's mitt and threw the ball against the wall. It makes sense.
Good and that's beat up catcher's
mitt. And I was going to ask him the same question until you did. It was a great question because I was like, how does a kid from Finland get so good at catching?
Yeah.
You wouldn't even think, like, because
young goalies out there,
yeah, just most keep Finnish wearing that goalies glove. Are like blockers of the puck, right? Like Kipper.
They get their just their bodies.
Yeah, they're
front.
Just good,
he was a catcher.
Yeah, so thank you to Pekka Rinne. It was another great weekend with him and everything. So up dog, he's a beauty, you're a beauty.
Yeah.
I was missing Curfew.
That's fella. Missing Curfew, fella. But every now and then when I get paid, I gotta spoil my baby with enough pay. Hey, hey, yeah, we fancy like Applebee's on a date night. Got that bourbon street steak with the Oreo shake and some whipped cream on the top too. Two straws, one check, girl, I got you. Bougie like Natty in the styrofoam. Squeaking in the trumpet.